Hi and welcome to our Open Stop Motion film project. Yesterday we were putting leaves on the old oak, and now we need to make some more of these because I have used all of those I had. So these, you know, twigs that I glue the leaves on. So, and I used a bunch of them on this tree. I don't know how many, but 30, 40 or something like that. I usually, those small trees you can see behind are only, I use 6 or 7, 8 on each tree. But as you can see, there's a lot of trees behind it, and so we need to make a lot of those now. So that's what we are going to do tonight. And I clip threads in and bind them in bundles. Oh, it's hard to see. I better put a thread around, and then I have a bundle where there are 19 threads in each bundle, and then I spread them out like this: 3 on this side, 3 on this side, 5 on this side, 5 on this side, and 3 right up. So, but there are always a lot to do before we get a result like this. There's a lot of work involved in it, so. And I understand why some people think it's boring to look at, but it's not meant for you to look at this 4 hours in a row. It's meant for you to pass by and see how far we got, and maybe say hello, and we can have a little conversation or so. Always nice, and I can see the chat room from here on the channel. Make a real stop motion movie, then there is a lot of this type of work. But when Disney or Pixar or some of the other people make it, they have a lot of people to put on it, and here there is only one guy. So that's why it takes a little longer, or a little longer, much longer. But if any one of you have seen Box Trolls, than the dancing scene in the bookstore took 18 months to make. So it's even for a lot of people then it takes time. And they can throw all the money in the world after it. But I cannot. I don't have their thick wallet. We will get it done over time. If we keep at it all the time. Today it was granddaughter day, so and that sort of thing we need to attend to also. That's very important. Thank you. And the thread comes on roll like this. So, but when you can see when you open it, then it's kind of bent in. So I stretch it so I get a better. Get nice straight like these. Then they are much easier to work with. But I have to do this now because I cannot keep on make half finished stuff. I need, for example, I need to make the trees so I can see if I have enough trees or I shall make some more or whatever. And it's sometimes difficult to figure out up front how many you need with the compared to the amount of space I have and so on. everything has to fit together in the end. Because I want to build the landscape before I start to make more people and animals, so I can see the size I need and so on. One thing is depending on the other thing, and it's kind of improvising all the way. When you never have done it before, then in, at least not in this scale. It's much easier to take a Lego figure and then start to move him around, him around in a little simple landscape. But we are going big. Barely big. Then we'll see if I bit off more than I can chew. That can be. But I will die trying, so you'll see. What we can manage. I think I have to open the door because it's very hot in here. That's too small. Just sit here by the lamps. I have four big soft boxes on, so it's a little hot. And the boys outside are jumping on skateboards. So it can be a little noisy. But it's better than being cooked. And while I'm doing this, I can hear Windows Weekly with Paul Tarot and May Diopoli in live.twit.tv with Leo Laporte and company. Shall probably
sports, etc. Those are all really nice looking now.
Need
really
to nice. Make
and then it was they talked about it a change
least
of the apps functionality.
That thousand of these
we have understood, but I
so
guess in Windows 8.1 only Win32 yeah. apps can actually trigger an OS prompt that says you know, if you want to change
but
the
I will not do
anyway,
that at one time I will do those over time. When I have made a bunch of them, then I will put leaves on them and then put them on the trees and then go back to do this. Until I'm finished with all of them. So sooner or later we will have a forest. Any visits tomorrow, so I guess I can get some of them made before I get on here.
Like fall. Yeah, I think October launch and real, I mean, actual availability of devices in November. just look at the screen.
Yeah, I was going to say, based on the latest preview for that, which came out last week right after we did Windows Weekly, they delivered Windows 10 Mobile 10080. And I saw you and others and people say it's still pretty buggy, that phone build.
Phone build is a steaming pile.
Oh!
Phone build is really bad. And actually, the desktop PC build looks great. I mean, I just installed it, but it does look great. The phone build was notably bad from the second it was installed. And I'll give this warning out. It's too late, I think, for almost anybody who's going to hear it now. But wait, if you think back to February when they first announced the beta phones, there was a Windows Insider app that they had put out for the phone, and I installed it on my main phone, which is the Lumia 930, thinking the desktop builds look pretty good. You know, clearly the phone builds will look great. And then you may recall that first build in Asia only worked on 6 or 7 phones. It was all low-end stuff that was really disappointing. And so I kind of just forgot about it. You know, when the big build came out, they finally supported a bunch of phones. One of the few phones it didn't support was the Lumia 930. And so this whole time, the Insider app's actually been on my phone that I've been carting around all day long every day, but never doing anything because I just had one of those phones that never was going to get the build. So I kind of forgot it was there. I was testing it on other machines or other phones, and the phone builds have universally been pretty bad. And when this last build came out, I had forgotten about it. So one day I looked at my phone and I said, hey, you have a new update to install, and it was Windows 10, and I said, like, and there's no way to back out of it. Once this thing has downloaded and started the install process, you can put it off, and then it's going to say, hey, on this day, this thing's installing, you know. And I woke up, I think it was yesterday, and this thing had installed Windows 10, and now my phone doesn't work. So I've had to switch to my 1520 temporarily until I'm going to have to wipe it out. It literally doesn't work.
I saw a bunch of people saying this happened to them on Twitter, and they're like, now what do I do? Like, I didn't want that build, and now it's just automatically going to come to my phone every time.
A lot of people say, well, so there must be some way to short-circuit this, right? Maybe uninstall the app, or, you know, nope. Anyway, it's barreling down the tracks. So I'm going to have to, and you will have to, if this has happened to you, use the Lumia software recovery tool to go back to whatever the last supported version is, probably 8.
That scares me.
You said I always had good luck with it, but, well, for example, so I don't actually have luck. One of the things that's on this phone is every single photo I've taken in 2015, right? Now, granted, I have downloaded a bunch of them to my PC or to OneDrive or whatever, but, you know, I kind of want to make sure I don't lose any of these things, and that's 8 gigabytes of photos. So that's one thing I had to deal with. So even though it's like the screen won't come up, in fact, it's funny, I picked it up, it's like this warm, right? If you can see it, it would be funny because this will actually work, right? So it looks fine, it looks normal. And then you do the lock screen thing, and you tap the code. It tells me it's wrong because I can never do it right the first time. And this is what the start screen looks like. It just says, loading. And this will never correct itself. Right. The entire time I've had Windows 10 on this phone, I've seen the start screen one time, and I was able to launch an app, and then that was it. I've never seen it come back. So it's just never. It will sit here like this. This will never. It will never fix. It's just never.
Somebody saying in the chat room a hard reboot will fix it. Maybe try
a hard reboot.
Like reset, you know. Like what is it?
That wipes out of it.
Oh, that's right.
Sure. I can wipe it out. Yeah. I know it's terrible. Or I could just go back to 8.1.
Is there a way to reset it without erasing stuff?
No.
No. Okay. Because that's what they're saying. They're saying reset it. But you don't want to do that because that's
garbage. I've done everything I can do.
Yeah.
So
I think the tool would also erase it, right?
Yeah, you're right. Because what it's doing is downloading the retail image and then it's blowing away whatever's on the phone and blasting the stock image.
Well, there's a little word of caution.
Yeah, again, it's delivered a little too late for most people, sadly. This thing came out about 6 days ago.
Not for me, because I didn't update my 1520 yet. So,
I've never done this before, but I had this previous on my 1520. I had it on an 830, I think, 635. I had whatever it was on, I can't remember. Whatever three phones.
at this point, if you haven't installed the beta, right, why wouldn't you wait 2 months?
Right? I know, I'm waiting.
And we don't know, or do we know, what the experience will be like for those who are running the beta when the full version comes out. In the past, it's not been a good experience. They have said that they intend to support them. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And once again, I ask, what could go wrong? If you're tactical enough to have been installing this thing all along, you actually updated build profile or whatever, you're gonna wanna clean this stuff. You want to start install whether you need to or not. But that's kind of my point is if you haven't done it yet, you're obviously not a fast ring type of guy or gal.
Yes.
You're a slow ring. And so wait 2 more months, that's all. Right?
Right.
Mary Jo, are you a fast ring kind of guy?
I am not.
She's a slow ringer, I can tell.
I am.
A dead ringer, you might say. So,
I just don't see, especially at this point, it's like, it's fit and finish now. So, if you're really, really in a rush to see it before July, okay. Or, if you're a developer, you would have already been installing it. You would have
or IT person.
Right.
Do you think businesses are actively, well, that sounds the word. Do you think businesses are actively considering going from 7 to 10?
Some are. Yeah, some are, definitely. And a lot of people are starting already to kick the tires in very controlled ways and controlled settings, just seeing how much of the learning curve there's going to be and what they think of the experience now and whether they actually do want to plan for the upgrade.
Right.
So yeah, I think people are doing that.
So if they might quite reasonably be somebody who's saying, well, it's coming down the pipe at me and they're looking.
Yeah.
But they're not going to put it on a production machine because they have all those old computers lying around.
Not now, especially.
When you fire the CEO, they got his old computers, so put it on now.
Yeah. It's getting there, though. And it's one other thing about today's build I saw in the
shot
that's probably worth noting is if you have a machine using an AMD processor, you should be a bit wary about this build because they warned that
it was an AMD graphics.
Graphics.
That's different because a lot of people have that. I think a lot of people have an Intel CPU, but could have an AMD GPU.
You're right. Ooh. It's AMD GPU, and if you have that, if they warn Spartan, it could be crashy.
Ooh. Well, I better not put it on my Mac Pro. It's like it's really like a little snappy.
Exactly. Yeah.
I feel a little dead. and that's actually good to know. So I was going to put it on my Mac Pro. Two dual Radeons in there.
We'll crash twice as hard, Leo.
I am putting it on here so we can open it up, but I noticed the ISO I'm downloading is from April, so I'll have to download, install.
Yeah, and then update it, right? So I told some of the wrong information on Twitter, but the ISO is no bug to the slow ring, right? So,
but if you download the ISO and you're in the fast ring, it should give you an update pretty quick, right?
Yes.
Yeah,
yep.
We just never know which ones they're going to push to the slow ring. If they don't push every build that's in the fast ring to the slow.
Right. What about application compatibility? Somebody in the chat room is saying this Lightroom is not going to, the new Lightroom Creative Cloud is not loading. No. And then somebody else is saying I ran it with no issue. Oh, well.
I haven't checked every single application.
Every single
application.
How can you expect to be the guy who writes the book?
I will.
No, I know you.
Honestly, I was running a leaked build before this one. It was, I don't remember the exact build number. So this one's 122. I think it might have been
product, I guess they will still have it. They're not giving up product keys, even though they're giving away the operating system. You know what? We don't have another question.
I know.
I think it's fair to say there will be product keys.
Yeah, because not everything is free.
Right.
Yep. Yeah, you know, free or not, whatever. Let's say your computer gets Windows 10 for free because it qualifies.
Right.
There should be a product key tied to that hardware configuration. It makes sense to have that one-to-one relationship, right? And hopefully that's how it happens, because you can go back later, get the ISO, do a clean install. You can float away 2 years from now, do a clean install, it should just work.
Right.
So that's my expectation. But again, moving on.
What evil lurks
in the heart of the fast ring builds.
Well, this is exciting. Not such good news for Windows Phone 10. Put off build 10080. In the words of Paul Thread, it's a freaking mess.
It is a freaking mess. But the build, like you said, is one. Like this, because that's the way they hear things. So the version number is 10.0.12562.84.
Got it. Now, Paul, I'm just going to make a mention of this. Paul does his own graphics on his website. That's always been true, and no less true on Thurot.com. I recognize that's the Park Güell in Barcelona.
Yes, it is. Yep. Because they launched that phone at Mobile World Congress in Barcelona.
So that's a little Spaniard boy using this.
It's like a 640 XO.
And that's a real person? Or is he a model?
I assume it's a model, yeah.
Oh, it's not your picture.
It's a stock photo.
Stock photo. But I like the Park Güell. I think that's a nice touch. Yeah. Wonderful.
Yes, all of the 640, 640 XL stock photos have Barcelona.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Paul has on his website screenshots. Stuff and nonsense.
Yeah, it's
full of hamburgers, Leo.
Full of hamburger menu. Look at that.
We're going to talk about the Office apps. Apps for the Windows Phone build, right? So that's one thing that was new in that build the Paul disclosed. There, if you go to the beta store in the phone builds, you can get for the first time new Office apps for the Office Universal apps for Windows Phone, the touch first ones. And that's, we've been waiting for the preview of that since, I think, the end of April.
Right. Yeah. Since, I think, build was when they announced it, right?
Yeah, or just around that time, yeah.
Because it was delayed. We originally thought that was going to happen during Ignite, I think, originally, and then maybe the week after Ignite, and then, and I think it was, the delay was probably the build. The other thing you can get that way, by the way, in this build is the new Xbox app, right, which is going to replace the Smart Glass. It closely follows the PC version.
Okay, here we go. I'm installing it now. There you go. Fun.
See how it goes.
Let's take a break, and then I would like to kind of go details on how the upgrades and so forth, because you have more information on that, thanks to an Australian blogger. But first, a word from Lynda.com. Oh, I love Lynda.com. It's a great place to learn the stuff you would like to learn, whether it's for your business, you want to get a better job or promotion,
okay,
or for fun, for your hobby, or both. It doesn't have to be mutually exclusive. That's one of the beauty parts about Lynda.com. I want you to go to lynda.com/windows. Actually, you know what I'm going to do? Listen up. Or turn on your tone. That would take you right there. How do you like that, huh? Are we modern? Welcome, fans of Windows Weekly. Lynda.com. For the curious, for people who want to make things happen, for people who want to just have more fun in their hobbies. Maybe you want to take better photos. Maybe you want to learn HTML or master Excel or sharpen your Photoshop skills. They got it all. Some of the new Lynda Microsoft Project Relational Database Design with FileMaker Pro. What? I'm sorry, that's two different. Right there, that's two different courses. There's Advanced Microsoft Project, comma, Relational Database Design with FileMaker Pro. They're two very different things. But that shows you. How about Agile at Work? Planning with Agile User Stories. You know, I took this course because our new website was done agilely, and we had new user stories, and I didn't know anything about that. So, boy, this was a great course. I've talked about Code Clinic before, their multi-course series. You get lynda.com's experts. By the way, their experts are great teachers and real experts in the field. So in Code Clinic, you get a code challenge, and they offer solutions. They have a bunch of experts in different languages, C++, C#, Java, PHP, Python, and Ruby. And now JavaScript, C, R, and Swift. Windows 8.1 update, first look. Essential training, Microsoft Excel or Access. SharePoint online essential training. Now there's a course for you. With Gina Corder. This is a great course. This is, you want it. Lynda.com. LYNDA.com.
Welcome to SharePoint online essential training. My name is Ginny Corder. In this course, we will be taking a look at the features of Microsoft SharePoint online.
I'm just going to let that run in the background so we can all learn from Ginny. Watch and learn from top experts who are passionate about teaching, stream thousands of courses, more than 3,000 now at last count, on demand. Learn when you want, at your own pace. The courses are structured so you can watch them from start to finish, or you can watch a little bit here, a little bit there. Because they have full text transcriptions, you can actually jump to the part of the course that has the answer you need. So it's great reference material, too. You can even download them and watch them on your Android or iOS device. Lynda.com. Whether you're looking to become an expert, passionate about a hobby, or you just want to learn something, lynda.com/windows. Sign up for your free 10-day trial today. lynda.com/windows. We thank them so much for their support. Windows Weekly. Theron and Mary Jo Foley are here. They're talking about Windows, and of course, as we get closer to the day, and I'm just fascinated to hear, because I got the impression that it wasn't going to be in July from last time we talked. Feel fairly confident.
I think we felt confident. Microsoft is just a partner who said it, like right. It's a rumor, but I haven't heard anybody I know, sources or otherwise, say it's not going to end of July.
Okay. All right.
Let's see.
All Microsoft will commit to is summer.
Yeah, I think they say late summer.
Late summer. Well, let's see, late end of July is not late summer. That's smack dab in the middle. In fact, it's early summer, because summer doesn't begin until June 20th.
Yeah. I think that's, for them, worst case scenario.
Yeah, I think they're smart. Under-promise, over-deliver. Isn't that the best way to go?
Yep.
Not necessarily.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
Good. That's good to know. Let's talk about what it's going to look like if you're doing the upgrade. Windows 10 upgrade paths with...
We're finally getting a little more.
This is from a... Australian partner blog, so presumably they got some information.
Yeah, so Richard Hay found this, who works at Paul's website.
Oh, I got confused because I looked at the website and I thought, wait a minute.
Yeah,
oh.
You're like, whose site is that?
Yeah. Wait a minute, why are we pointing to this piece of junk? But
I'm just happy that they're still promoting Windows 8 secrets over there inside, right?
Good, yeah, they know. Right there.
Yeah, so an Australian partner blog, which is a Microsoft blog, posted a list of which versions can upgrade to which versions. And that's something Microsoft didn't tell us when they announced the different versions. We asked, but they wouldn't say. So the partner blog said, it's pretty predictable what they said. They said if you're running Windows 8.1 or Windows 7 Home Basic or Home Premium, you're going to go to Windows 10 Home. So now at least we know that's...
We even speculated that's why they did the SKUs.
Yeah.
I mean, why have Home and
exactly.
Pro on a free version? Because
right. And so Windows 8.1 Pro go to Windows 10 Pro.
Right.
Also, the Windows 7 Professional and Ultimate also to Windows 8. Windows 10 Pro.
Oh, okay, let's get that. Okay, Ultimate goes to Pro. Okay, got it.
Ultimate goes to Pro. 8
because the option for this appears in the start menu, but it does not run. It can't find the option.
Oh, you're looking at the new version. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, it makes sense that it would be the same.
Yeah.
And I suspect that it will be. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, if you have Windows 8.1 today, there's something in there called. Actually, what's it called? I don't see it. Only because I already have the highest number. But if you have a lower end version of Windows 8.1, you can sort of bring it back up. Well,
it needs a little lubricant.
I don't know what I'm looking at anymore.
Who does?
It really didn't. Oh. I got it. I'm sorry. Get more features with the new edition of Windows.
Okay.
Is the name. Okay. See why this is not here. Get more features.
And bots writing Windows 10 upgrades won't be free for everyone. This is the business stuff.
Licensing.
Yeah.
This is actually consumer stuff he's writing about, but it's more, you know, it's reminding people about things like when you license a version of Windows, the license is attached to the device, not the person, you know, and
right.
He has some cases about what if you're running in a VM, what if you're a system builder, like what's it going to look like? We're all just trying to piece this stuff together because so far we've heard almost no specifics from Microsoft on this. They've given us the version names and that's good.
Remember, they promised to talk about this, but it hasn't really
happened.
Well, we got time. But I actually
was talking to WinHack.
Wait. Now it opens again.
That was above
by
this
itself.
Topic, but it was aimed at hardware makers, so
it was.
There was some info we could glean, and there's some stuff later on that we got on the phone that came from that, but. It's not the full story, and it's certainly not what consumers need to hear because there's just a lot of missing information.
Yeah, because so for it. Since I bought a retail 8.1 for my. I use it in virtualization on my Mac at home.
Right.
That would be upgrade, obviously.
Yep.
And I would get it, I could get an ISO. I mean, I had a CD, a DVD.
That flew a long way.
That said, chances are good that the machine you're transferring it from Worker 2 both already qualified for the Windows 10 free upgrade, right? And that's a good chance. It's a really good, that's a good point. Right, we're kind of splitting hairs a little there, but that's a good number. So it could be not better, right? Yeah. But we don't know.
Called current the same security fixes and all the same features. I know, it sounds really complicated, and I'm actually trying to make it simple, but just know that if you're a business customer and you want never to take a new feature, you're going to have to be on Windows 10 Enterprise. You cannot be on any other version.
Interesting.
I just want to clarify, but make sure I understood what you said. The only way to forever put off updates?
Yep, or at least for 10 years, probably, right?
Okay.
For so much
So the Enterprise version of Windows 10. And then, I guess that would be applied by some kind of corporate policy.
Right.
Depending on managing. Okay.
And that version, Windows 10 for Enterprise, is not free. That is one that you can't get for free. So in other words, if you're going to have to pay for that if you want that.
Oops.
To do this, and we're part of this too. They have to learn that. that way too, right? For themselves inside.
I think the crux of this is going to be what time period of business on, let's say, Windows Update for Business or WSOS, whatever, is going to be able to push back
WSOS?
Windows Server Update Services. WSOS. Have like an on-prem, it's basically an on-prem filter between Windows Update and their users. And it lets
We've talked about this before.
Yeah.
I want to make sure people understand.
Yeah.
That's my job here. I'm the acronym detector.
WSOS.
What's WSOS? So, okay, so I now have installed my ISO. I'm running Windows 10, but that's the old version. And how will I get the new one? Just kill
it. Also, click Advanced Options.
Concentrate, young man.
Chose to interpret it that is hurry up, download Windows 10, we want everyone. as possible. And then after a year, we're going to say, okay, it's still free forever. No.
Maybe.
No.
Well.
Well, I mean, I suppose that could happen too. But you know what? Remember when Windows 8 launched, it was $30, $40 for an upgrade, and for a limited time, and everyone thought they're going to keep it that way. They have to, and they didn't.
Yeah, that was a shocker.
Yeah, so when Microsoft did announce that free for a year deal back in January, they said if you're on Windows 8.1, Windows 7 Server 1, or Windows Phone 8.1, you can upgrade to Windows 10 for free for the first year that the operating system is available. So my assumption was what yours was, Leo. It's like, and after that, you probably will pay, right? But I guess...
No, that was not my assumption.
That was mine.
No. I'm sorry. Let's say you have received the free update. Yeah. So now it's a year later. You're not paying for it then.
No, you're not. So that's the part everybody gets confused about. This
a lot of people got confused about that.
Right. There were stories
out there. It's hard to word this clearly.
It really is. So if you are somebody who takes that 1 year free deal and you get Windows 10 sometime between July 2015 and July 2016, let's say if it launches in July. After that, if you have it for free, you're going to keep getting updates for free.
Yes.
You're not suddenly going to start paying for updates next July. That's not what this means.
Good.
It means
it
if you decide
to like
not to take the free
usability mode or something.
No,
it's not that.
You got
if
you're a full fledged member of the Windows community.
You're in the club. Yep.
And you're in for the lifetime, the support lifetime of that machine.
The device.
Something. They say the hardware, but.
Right. But if you didn't take the deal, say you decide, you know what, I'm not ready to do this yet, I don't want that first year deal, and then say next September 2016, you go, you know what, now I want to go to Windows 10. Unless Microsoft extends the free 1 year deal, you're going to have to pay something to get it.
Well, who was confused about that?
Oh man, everybody. I've gotten so many questions and queries, because a lot of people thought this meant after the first year, you were going to start paying for upgrades. That's not what it
means. Well, that I understand, but you know, someone who decided all along not to upgrade, and now it's 15 months later. And you know what? I think I do want to upgrade to Windows 10. I mean, did people really think
deal.
That?
I guess they thought it was going to be like, yeah, they did it this year, but they're going to just extend it indefinitely. And
They may.
We don't know, right? But
well, we can't see the future, sure. But
I feel like. So why give it away for a year and then start charging for it?
Why only for 1 year?
Would you do that?
To rush everybody to upgrade.
And that's why they're saying that. But imagine the upset the day after, when all of a sudden it's $159.
No, but who are those people that 366 days later, or whatever, now I really want to do it. What do you mean they canceled the deal? I mean, what is this audience? I don't understand.
Well, people aren't paying attention. You see, we pay attention.
People who don't pay attention deserve to be
punished. Herein lies the problem. It's that mindset, I think.
There's also, so I'll make another case of people who might delay. Business users who want Pro, right? Say you're a business user.
Yeah, because they don't want force updates.
You don't say you're on Windows 7 Pro or Windows 8.1 Pro right now.
Yeah.
You're a business customer.
Yeah.
And Microsoft comes out with Windows 10. You're like, you know what? I'm going to let people kick the tires for a bit and see how this goes. I'm not ready to upgrade. And or your company says, you can't upgrade for 2 years.
Yeah. By the way, that will be a lot of companies.
That's very common.
That will be.
That's probably the default position. Well, but if the plan, so first of all, this is a non-enterprise, right? So this is a smaller business.
Right.
It's my business.
Small business.
It's my business.
Right.
And your business. And, you know, maybe that's your attitude. I don't want to do this right away. But you're not, you know, 6 months. You're not going to wait a year, because it's not free after a year, right?
That's why
unless they extend the deal.
Which I think they will, but they ain't going to say anything until then.
Right.
If your plan is to assume they're going to change their policy, this is just flawed.
I know.
Maybe they will. But I don't count.
But the idea, Microsoft's idea is, let's get as many people to upgrade to Windows 10 as soon as we can. Right? That's the game. So the way you do that, make it free. saying on Twitter. You know the people who want the placeholder replacement on OneDrive and who are going to stay with Windows 8? Yep, there's that group. That group exists,
yeah.
And those people also
right. Well, put feature X here. Feature, you know, I love the charms bar. I mean, there's got to be there's any given feature
yep.
they don't want to give up. You know,
well,
what
we're
not is our editors. Because we, those machines, we have to make sure that Premiere works as
right.
expected.
Right, so there has to be some kind of testing that occurs to make sure it's okay. But if you're relying on whatever, I mean, I get it. I get waiting, but, you know, wait 10 or 11 months. Don't, you know.
Yeah.
We they're using Windows 8.1, by the way. They're not using Windows 7.
I, by the way, the question, too, I mean, what if we should know the price, right? So, in other words, there's all kinds of things that can happen. But let's just say, within the first month of RTM / GA, we're going to know what the upgrade cost is.
Right.
I would just $40.
Well, then it's no big deal.
Then,
right?
then who cares?
It's 20. Right.
It's
under
$100,
right.
then we have a problem. The other thing is, since we're speculating, what the hell it's fun, you know, Microsoft might, at that expiration of the 1 year, say, okay, so now it's not free, the year is expired, but now we have a special deal.
Right.
The upgrades are going to be half price for the next year or something. Maybe they go up in price over time. The longer you wait, the more you pay. I don't know. All kinds of things that could happen. Honestly, that OneDrive thing you said was probably the best excuse I've heard so far.
Yeah, but even the TriCaster says the same.
He tweeted.
Waving hand. I'm one of those people who's going to wait.
TriCaster never gets upgraded. It was running Windows XP till recently.
Yeah.
There you go.
There are people who need to wait or want to wait or are being forced to wait.
For those people, we salute.
You're not hasty
right.
decision makers.
Right. And the piracy thing, I think we now know.
We've always known.
We've always known. It's not.
No,
there's no amnesty program. This is not.
Nope. Nothing has changed.
Come in from your.
The only thing they said in that post, though, I will say, there was one bit. I kind of printed the whole thing out on paper, but, and then kind of commented on each section. And each time it was like, yep, we already knew that. Yep. Do that, get party, do that. And then there was this line. It said, in partnership with some of our valued OEM partners, by which they mean PC makers, we're planning very attractive Windows 10 upgrade offers for their customers running one of their older devices in a non-genuine state. Stay tuned to learn more from our partners on the specifics of their offers. So that sounds like the Lenovo's, HP's, Dell's of the world are going to reach out to customers of theirs who are running their hardware but have a non-genuine version of Windows on there, and they're going to offer some kind of a special deal to get Windows 10 genuine version, which sounds like something's new. Something new. Thing is, they actually already offer this, by the way. Microsoft sells something to their partners called the Get Genuine Kit, and I would assume that this thing that they're talking about is in fact just a Windows 10 version of that, so it may just be a new version of something that already exists. But that's potentially new information.
Like that. Potentially new information.
Listen, I would love to have an answer to every question.
But that's
but
the
I
show.
Am
that's
I,
your
I
job.
Think I am literally being as precise as I can.
Yeah, no, you are. That's all we ask. We do not ask more precision than you are.
The fact that be as precise as I can be as humorous is because we have a
Now, this was the one I thought was very interesting, and I really wanted to get your take on it. We talked about it on Twitter on Sunday, which is Microsoft basically saying, I think it was a blog post, we are going to make sure all Windows phones are up to date, and that's our job. We're going to update those. We're going to go around the computers.
Yeah, they didn't really, I'm not really sure they say that.
They implied it, I guess. But
here's the thing. Something magic hasn't happened where the carriers can kind of picture.
Well, yeah, it's not like the Microsoft did a lot of leverage.
That's what I mean. So, I mean, we all want to believe this is true.
And that's how it is on the iPhone.
iPhone 7.
But Steve Jobs negotiated stiff terms when the iPhone came out, and those terms
are different. Well, by the way, after being rejected by other carriers, finally Singular said yes to everything
right.
that he demanded.
Right.
The iPhone took off eventually. and now he sets, or Apple sets the terms. There's no going back. You know, Apple's the only company that gets that.
But why would that? Okay. So, certainly on Android, there's carrier specific stuff on every Android phone. There's manufacturer specific stuff on every Android phone. So, yep. When Android is updated, the first the manufacturers and then the carriers have to do soak tests and update, blah blah blah. And often they don't even bother updating. That's one of the reasons.
I have a Samsung Galaxy S5 that was brand new.
Yeah.
About a year ago.
Yeah.
And it's not on Android 5. Anything.
No.
In fact, it's the only version of this phone that is not.
Yeah.
If you have this on Verizon or T-Mobile or whatever, you got that update.
Yeah.
Not get it. I'm on AT&T.
If you have a Note 4, you're hoping you didn't get the update because it broke. But that's another thing.
Okay, but, you know,
great.
Microsoft sells it to you directly, sans contract, unlocked.
Right.
They can't bypass the carriers to deliver these kinds of
the data. Why? But can't they just push the data down? I mean, why do the carriers have to get involved? I see if it went over carriers' networks.
Because the carrier is the one that has the agreement with Microsoft to sell that device.
Ah.
And part of that agreement is they get to call the shots because they don't want certain things on the network. It doesn't matter if this makes sense, by the way. I want to be really clear. It doesn't matter what
there's
the
no technical. There's no technical reason for it.
Absolutely no technical reason.
Yeah.
Because a lot of people will say, well, I mean, why not just let it go over Wi-Fi? Which I would say, absolutely, why not?
Right.
Because carriers, that's why not.
And
I don't understand in this day and age, I've said this a million times, I think, every single day on any phone, I don't care what kind of phone you have, Windows Phone, Android, iOS, you're updating tens, hundreds of megabytes, possibly more, of app updates every single day. You can do that over your cellular network, you can do it over Wi-Fi. For some reason, no one has a problem with this. These apps could do, they're sandbox, they get it. But as far as like them consuming data, doing stuff over cellular, they have those permissions, they could abuse the network in various ways. No one has ever tried to stop this from happening. When Microsoft wants to ship a security update for Windows Phone or a functional update to a CoreOS component, and suddenly that's a problem. And I don't understand it. I completely agree and understand why people are disgruntled over this. And I, what can I tell you? All I know is these companies supposedly test these updates. Microsoft has provided them with a lot of data. I think the plan going forward is to provide them with Windows Insider users who are using that app to update early and saying, look, it went out to X number of users. No one's had any problems on all of the devices that are on your network. Please release the update. And I'm telling you, they have never done anything that they've said they were going to do, and they've never done the right thing. So I don't understand why we think they're going to change that. I feel like a broken record. This
yeah.
is me from 2010. I had this argument with Microsoft.
And they never, and it's never happened before. You were right, and you were right all along.
It's never.
It's a goal, right? I think that's the thing. Microsoft. This is like.
Their piece is a goal. I mean, I don't. You know,
right.
Sure. Making that announcement. And they, I mean, am I wrong? Did I misread it? It felt like they made that announcement, no?
What they said?
In January, he said, it would have been Terry Myerson would have said something to this effect on stage, because we asked them about it, remember, when we were heading over to do Windows Week.
Right.
And they said to us that they have a plan, and that they will reveal more information later. I think the insinuation was
there. Then at Ignite, when they announced Windows Update for Business, in that blog post they said, Microsoft's new continuous update policy will apply to all devices,
yes.
including phones.
That's the one I'm talking about.
But they never said
yeah, but
how.
You know what?
Like how?
Yeah,
how is it going to work?
If you have bought a phone, let's just use AT&T, the punching bag of phone. If your company is using AT&T and you've deployed Lumias, whatever's they are, to your workforce for some reason, that company doesn't exist, but let's just pretend that would be. Microsoft is delivering updates through Windows Update for Business, it doesn't matter, for a phone. They think that the carrier isn't going to be at the end of that chain. Microsoft will have come through on their end of the agreement. Windows Insiders will get it because they have that app on their phone. And I don't think they're going to be able to ship one of those phones out of the general populace. I really don't, unless the carrier still.
4 to 6 weeks of when we release a feature. So they had a whole plan for how to do this, but even that plan seems to imply that somehow carriers are going to be part of that.
By the way, it doesn't just apply it. There's a slide that shows it. There's a green box.
The one that says validate OTA updates.
Right. Those green boxes, the green means not Microsoft, partners. Partners aren't just hardware makers. Partners are also the carriers.
Right.
Validate over-the-air updates on retail phones. It does that. In other words, it's not getting pushed to the production server until that step happens. And that's where the wireless carrier gets in the way. I don't think anything's changed. I really don't think anything's changed.
I think they, just like before, they would love to have this happen. They'd love to be able to move around the carriers because the carriers have just been holding all of us hostage with these updates. And they know it, and we know it. And the goal is to get everybody on the same, most up-to-date release. But as long as the carrier is in that,
the carrier model does not coincide with what is best for us as users and what is best for Microsoft as the maker of the platform.
You said a mouthful there.
Yeah. Right. I mean, what they want is for you to be unhappy that your phone is not being updated so you get a new phone. If you go to them, they'll say, here's an idea. We have this program called Next, and using Next, you can tack a little bit of extra money onto your plan every month, and you can get a new phone every year, whatever the time frame is. There's probably a few choices. So don't worry about getting updates on your Lumia, whatever, because after 1 year, you can move along to a Lumia something else. You can move along to an iPhone, which, by the way, gets updates all the time, or an Android device. You can take chances there as well. And they're making money when they do that. That's their interests being pushed forward, and our interests being pushed to the, pushed aside.
So there.
I just don't see any reason why it doesn't happen.
And then to kind of close the loop on this, when beta went back to Microsoft, when these reports through EdBot and other people came out saying, Microsoft's going to cut the delay out, Microsoft said to when beta, we will continue to work closely with mobile operators on testing to meet and exceed quality bars. So they're saying they're still in the picture.
Yeah, they have to be.
And if they are, I don't see what Microsoft can do to stop them.
Here's one thing they can do. They can sell phones directly,
right?
Microsoft's part of the program. This hasn't been a gangbuster business for Google. They do that with the Nexus line of phones, whatever. But this is, they could at least say, and by the way, they sort of do this with PCs. The signature PC as a service is sort of the PC analog to this, right? Here are the phones, you got them, plus there's no crapper on them. It doesn't matter what the sort of crapper, but you're not locked to a carrier. And if they're smart, they'll make these things with multiple, radios, so they work everywhere, one phone, not multiple phones. The Windows Phone business model right now is such that, at least with Lumia, they basically sell the same phone to different carriers, and it's like these little mini exclusives. They change the model number a little bit. They sometimes it's dual SIM, sometimes it's LTE, sometimes it's LTE with dual SIM, sometimes it's a different size screen. It's really the same stuff. They change the version number a little bit to give everyone a little, special version of the same thing. And it's slightly different stupid phones all over the place. They could just have a smaller set of phones, unlocked, no contract, multiple carrier support, bring your own SIM.
Could the carrier still stop updates that way, though?
No, they can't.
No. So right now, if you have an unlocked phone and you're, say, on AT&T, when Microsoft pushes out an update, don't you have to wait until your carrier pushes it to you, unless you're on the developer program?
So we don't actually technically have these types of phones today. So if I go to Expansys, right, I buy, what I'm buying is a phone that was unlocked from, I don't know how they get unlocked. We don't really technically have the thing I'm asking for, but that phone's from somewhere, right?
Yeah.
So I get that, you get the update from, based on whatever, wherever it's from, so the 930 here that I just worked. That was a Thailand-based phone. It's not associated with a particular carrier in Thailand, but it is a Thailand-based phone. When Thailand got the Lumia demo update,
instances of this, but if Microsoft were to discover a zero-day attack that was effective on Windows Phone, presumably they could go to the carriers and say, look, this is some kind of exception. You need to let us push this update out. We know you need to test it, but this is important. It's not about delivering a new calendar or something stupid. It's presumably that's part of their agreement. I seem to remember there being some language to that effect, but I don't actually think that's ever happened, right? I what they really need is the ability just to bypass these companies altogether. And I think selling them directly, but you know, they have everything in place. They already do it with services. Maybe they have the same thing. Obviously, there's no wireless carrier in the way, but you know, you make the phones, you have a store. You know, just do that. I mean, I guess the problem would be if they ever did that, it's possible that some group of wireless carriers might then come to them and say, well, congratulations on your new phone venture. We're not going to be selling any more of your phones directly to
consumers. Oh, there's plenty of ways they can screw.
Yeah, they can.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, they're good at that.
And
that's the one.
It's probably even just a contractual violation. I mean, you know, you can't.
Yep. Microsoft would have done that in a heartbeat.
We're Microsoft.
Let's not pretend we don't miss them.
Verizon, AOL. What kind of company is that?
Here's what I think of your contract. You could shower in that contract.
Well, at least I get Candy Crush Saga. Thank God.
You know what the big unanswered question about Candy Crush Saga is?
What is the big unanswered question? Is there one? What is it?
Is this only for Windows 10 on PCs, or is it also for Windows phones?
This is the one they showed where it was the port from iOS, right?
Yeah.
How easy it was to do that. But that isn't those ports are
actually on phones. This is actually, I don't think this app is available yet.
Oh, I see.
Those PCs.
This says Candy Crush has been written for a Windows phone, right? And then it says Microsoft will bundle Candy Crush Saga with Windows 10. It doesn't say.
It's bundled! I'm so excited! Instead of mine, we did it there. Well,
you're not the people who want Microsoft to bundle Hadoop, I can tell you that. Not those people.
You search for Candy Crush Saga in the Windows 10 store.
I know.
Crapola stuff, which is like strategy guide, ultimate GS
yeah, so on. Right. I don't think it's out yet. I think that's the point. It's not actually out yet.
Yeah.
So in other words, at some point right after the release of Windows 10, you're going to, I mean, I can only imagine they will, I don't know how they're going to deliver it. Either a Windows update, which would be infuriating, or maybe it'll just be like an auto update in the store or something.
Maybe it could
be. Good news is it's universal having here.
Could be on the RTM, why not?
If you read the announcement, I don't believe that it is in Windows. They describe how you get Windows 10 and then it appears on the computer.
It's a sign of the times. Instead of Spider Solitaire and Minesweeper, look at Candy Crush Saga and, I don't know, Angry Birds. You gotta figure, you know, Candy Crush Saga is free. So it's not like it's such a great deal. You can get it in 3 seconds. I would bet it's a profit deal.
Me too.
That the guys at Candy Crush said, how much would it cost to make sure that every version of Windows ships with us?
Let me give you my imagined story of how this happened, and you will agree immediately that this is almost certainly what happened. Microsoft went to them and said, hey, we're developing this software that will let you port iOS apps and games to Windows Phone. We'd like for you to try it on Candy Crush Saga. And they said, that's hilarious.
But
why would we do that? Nobody uses Windows Phone. Right. And they were like, well, maybe there's some other way we can come to an agreement. And the agreement was, I have an idea. How about you make this, you just give it away to everyone who has Windows 10. They probably said something to these guys like, our goal is to have Windows 10 go out to 1 billion people. And they were like, really? Well, now we can talk. You know, how about we give it away to those 1 billion people? I'm pretty sure that's what happened. This game is over three years old now.
According to Edward Snowden, there's maybe another reason for putting Candy Crush Saga on Windows 10. According to Snowden, the NSA uses Candy Crush and Angry Birds.
That's awesome.
To leak your location information to the National Security Agency. How about that?
Well, they know where I am now. I'm recording a podcast. You can see my house.
Driver.
USA, the hyperlapsy way. I am.
Yes, this is quick.
I am intrigued by the notion that Microsoft is reinventing email for iOS. I find that intriguing. You want to talk about that a little?
Yeah. So Microsoft is seemingly because this information comes from a leaked page that our friend Walking Cat on Twitter found. It's a new lightweight email application called Flow that is not meant supposedly to be a replacement for Outlook. It's meant to be a complement. So it's almost like a chat app from the description that you can use. It's still email, but you can go without subject lines or salutations or signatures. You can just have this conversation with one other person, and it will be part of your Outlook email. You'll be able to search that particular conversation separately. Exchange will be on the back end. But it's meant to be kind of not Outlook, like something lighter than Outlook, an alternative for people who might, you know, gravitate to other messaging platforms or other chat or social networking.
It's not a new idea. It's not a new idea on iOS.
It's not. Yeah,
doesn't Microsoft have another product called Flow, or am I wrong? No.
They have another product. This is what I likened it to. They have something called Skype Quick, which is a video chat app that's meant to be a lightweight chat app, similar to kind of what you do with SMS or IM, but for video. And I think Flow is like Skype Quick, except it's for email. That's kind of how I'm explaining it when I try to explain it.
No, it's not out yet, right? I should know.
Not out yet, but the leaked page says it's going to be out for iPhone.
Well, that's what everybody uses, isn't it? I mean,
everybody. Everybody uses it. Except us who are in the 3%.
Yeah. Everybody else is using Creative Report.
We don't know when or if it's coming also to Windows Phone or Android. Microsoft's not talking about it yet. But my guess would be it would come to all of the platforms.
Yeah. Just like Sway did. Yeah, all the platforms.
Someday.
My sway will come. I'll look forward to this. And Paul has a little piece on Microsoft's secret plan.
Well, in other words, no, I did okay. I mean, it makes sense that they would take their traditional products and move them to mobile devices, right? And some people consider it kind of shocking, right? When they put Office on iPad, a lot of people are like, what are you doing? I think that makes sense, but you know, that's not enough. If all Microsoft was going to do is ship a bunch of their old stuff on new platforms, that's not necessarily enough. And so with things like Office Mix and Office Sway, Skype Quick, like Joe said, or this new Flow add-on for Outlook, this is giving us clues to the new Microsoft, you know, that it's not just about old ways of doing things.
See, that's why I
like, what are the
new
productivity
doing stuff,
you know,
because else
I think
they fall apart. And somehow, this wasn't tight enough.
And they're all short product names. That can
that's what I was just trying to find. So, Mary Jo, Sway, Flow.
Yeah,
we shared a bunch of names that would be potential Microsoft product names. The ones that Mary Jo came up with were Fold, Stir, Broil, and Bake.
Microsoft Block. I think there's
Bud.
Microsoft Bud.
Thud.
I like Thud. Yeah.
I'm running Microsoft Thud on my iPhone.
I like it. It's snappy. It's quick.
Yep.
It's like getting hit in the face with a brick.
This is the four-letter word.
We're going to talk about two things in this podcast in the future. One, you're going to be crazy cloud services that you used to do.
I'll need the bathroom for a second.
Four-letter names. I'm using weak.
low-end crap is false note.
Oh, you like the 640? Actually, the 640 is a pretty decent phone. It's a mid-level phone. It's cheap. It's $120 off contract. It is locked on Cricket, but it's coming to T-Mobile soon as well. It's not bad. It's not like a, you know, it's, they have a lot of low-end phones. This one's a step up. It's pretty decent.
That's one on our list I didn't even know about. So that's
your fault. So President Obama was having a meeting, I guess, yesterday to start the discussion about what the United States is going to do, if anything, about policy regarding encryption and U.S.-based computer products, right? This all started because Apple last year decided to ship encryption in the fall, which a lot of law enforcement people complained about. Are you getting bombarded by birds or something?
No, it's just like...
Is there a guy in the ledge like out there? What's going on?
There's always weird sounds in my building that I'm curious
about. It's some guy like is going to swing through your window. You know?
I know.
Oh! Something to do like restrict the use of encryption. I wrote this up because I really care about music services.
And then I was running low on coffee, so had to make some more of that.
I see Spotify again had another announcement today, like Leo said, about advancing the video. It's a big announcement because we're in it. And I have to think, you know, if Microsoft isn't serious about Xbox Music to the point where they have apps on Android and iOS and that kind of thing, and they don't.
And it's starting to get cold.
People will do like a roundup of internet streaming services, and Starbucks Music is never part of it, right? So now Starbucks has gotten into what is still sort of like an Apple partner, but I think they'll be a more Apple partner soon, and they're in Starbucks.
Yeah.
And so they're going to be doing the music of Starbucks. They're going to be giving free premium accounts to Starbucks employees. It's kind of a major deal. I mean, it's just a personal point of like 7,000 retail.
Talk about Braintree, and not talking Braintree Mass.
up the road a bit from Dedham. But I bet you that's where they started. I'm just thinking that's probably why they call themselves Braintree. It's actually, though, I could say it's because it's really smart.
That's right.
And it's like a money tree where it's just you shake it, money comes out for you. If you're a mobile developer, oh, Braintree, you gotta love it. The payment solution. It's used by the biggest and best in the business. You Uber and Lyft. Right there, that tells you something. Airbnb and hotel tonight. Living Social. GitHub actually started the Braintree and has Braintree scaled right up with them. From your first dollar to your billions, Braintree has made payment experiences seamless and magical for so many, and now you can do the same with excellent customer service, simple integration. Braintree gets you ready to receive payments quickly. And Braintree's continuous support and fast payouts means you're going to be prepared as your company grows from your first dollar to your billions of dollars. They're just awesome. By the way, there's a big, I can't remember what the number is, I think it's 70% of mobile carts are abandoned at checkout. So if somebody goes to all the trouble to go through your app, pick out stuff, put it in the cart, goes to the cart, and then 70%, 7 out of 10 customers walk away because it's too hard, too complicated, or they don't want to enter a credit card number, whatever. And that's why your mobile payment solution is so important. And Braintree is really addressing that issue of mobile card abandonment. They have the best checkout experience anywhere. They take payments from Apple Pay, from PayPal, Bitcoin, Venmo, of course credit cards. They make it seamless and magical for you and your customers. So I want you to try it. It's a full stack payment solution. All payment types across the board. Secure fraud protection, customer service, fast payouts. And if this weren't enough, I'm going to get you your first $50,000 in payments fee free. $50,000 in transactions fee free. BraintreePayments.com/windows. You were right. BraintreePayments.com. This is go down the road from Paul. Turn left on Route 128. And there it is. Braintree Famous.
Fairly accurate.
.com. Everything's turned left on Route 128. BraintreePayments.com/windows, or unless you go by 95. But I like the mass turn left myself.
Well, actually, for that stretch of road, they're the same.
Yeah. It's got the little pilgrim's hat with an arrow through it. I always thought that that really was kind of a counterproductive logo.
That's the master. The master.
I don't. It seems like that's something. What? You really want to emphasize that?
Sending mixed messages.
It's a little mixed.
My favorite part about Windows, about Route 128 is that when you go south of 128, which is south of 95, and then 95 veers off, and you're still on 128 going south, but now you're also on 93 going north. Massachusetts.
That's it.
It's like, makes no sense at all.
Have you ever tried to drive in Boston? My God, insane.
Yep.
Insane.
Well, at least there's great signs everywhere, so you're fine.
It's like every big closet.
But the state trooper, right, with the directions. I told you to stop.
Oh, well, Tom,
he said, what do I look like, Ram?
Officer, how do I get to
coffee machine is coming. That's a good thing.
What do I look like? F. Rand McNally?
State trooper, you're in tax knowledge of work.
Yeah. Pilot yourself. I don't know what he's really saying. I got no idea.
Yeah, he has no idea.
I got no idea.
Actually, his eventual advice was to drive into the tunnel with all the signs in front of it that said, don't drive into the tunnel. I'm serious.
See that big thing over there?
Don't worry about the signs. Just go.
Go. What could possibly go wrong? Tip of the week for Paul Theron.
Crazy. So I mentioned that I'm probably going to be splitting the Windows 10 book into like a mobile book and a non-mobile book, right? And so one of the little side things about this is I've never completed the Windows Phone 8.1 book. This is too much to do, I think, especially with moving to the new site this year. So I think I'm going to skip over that. And what I'm going to do instead is detail a bunch of stuff that's new between 8.1 and 8, right? If you update from Windows Phone 8 to 8.1. And so this week I started doing some of that stuff. This is stuff that was in the book. It was going to be in the book. And so
first three are on now, and it's basically kind of really neat Windows 8.1, Windows Phone 8.1 features that are differentiators from previous versions. Wi-Fi Sense, Storage Sense, and Data Sense. I'll do one on Battery Saver next, but Data Sense is, or I should say these Sense apps are mostly settings apps, although usually one of them isn't. And they allow you to do such things as, you know, monitor your data usage, limit your data usage over cellular, you know, jump over to Wi-Fi networks automatically. The Wi-Fi Sense feature has a cool feature where there are over a million public hotspots that require some kind of authentication. You know, you go to a web page, you put in a name, a phone number, maybe, or an email address, and then it lets you onto the network.
They
entangled. People actually log you onto those networks using the focus data, which is kind of hilarious. And then Storage Sense, which lets you manage the data on the device, which is particularly important if you have, well, I'm running out of space, you can figure out what it is, or if you have an SD card and you want to do things like, well, I was using the internal storage for apps, and for data, for music, and, you know, other things. I want to move that stuff over the card. This app gives you the capability to do that. So just basically, these are the first three. There's going to be a bunch more of these, and I'll be doing this over the next few weeks. So if you're using Windows Phone, and then the software pick, actually, I like your idea of Hyperlapse. I should have added that, and so I'll just add that as one. Hyperlapse is available. I think it's actually is it on all three? It's iOS, Android, and Windows Phone.
And we have one more.
I think Android is the last, and it's
really short when I. So you'll have to do that.
Yeah, you have to do the Google Plus community. I did a short one of going through the car wash. It's on YouTube.
No, I think the coffee is ready. And something for the headache.
It's of slightly less interest to kind of Microsoft watchers because it's not Microsoft anymore, but it's a great app. You should definitely check it out.
Is it, you do have to subscribe, right? I mean, is it a,
you can, but you don't have to. That is your, yeah, you do, it's cheap. I don't subscribe, but I want to say it's like $3.99.
Oh, that's a good deal.
It's not expensive.
Our enterprise pick of the week comes to us from Mary Jo Fulman.
My pick of the week is something called the convenience roll-up. And convenience roll-ups are packages of hot fixes that Microsoft makes available every once in a while, where they take like 70 hot fixes that they issued over a number of months. They roll them all up. You can install them as a single package and only have to reboot once, I believe. So Microsoft issued a few of these over the past couple of years. There was one back in 2013 that we wrote about called Slow Boot, Slow Login Hotfix Rollup. That was 90 hot fixes for Windows 7 and Windows Server
2019. They used to call service packs, right?
They're very similar to service packs, yes.
No, it's a convenience.
It's a convenience for you and me to get things. Great. So now, here's the big news. There's going to be another one of these for Windows 7 and Windows Server 2008 R2 coming sometime probably around the release of Windows 10. I don't know how many hot fixes that thing's going to roll up, but supposedly quite a few. And Microsoft is billing it as if you're on Windows 7 Service Pack 1, Windows Server 2008 R2, you're going to want to apply this convenience when it comes out to help you get ready for Windows 10. But even if you're not really getting ready for Windows 10, it will be a much more convenient way for you to get all those hot fixes and apply them at once. So the idea is to watch
yeah.
this coming.
And when you apply those fixes, then you are.
Bill, you got a code name for us?
I do. And another one, I'm not quite sure how to pronounce it. It's Tachino.
Wirecast go down. And you cannot start it, so.
It's on Swift.
We will not do that.
So, Ticino is a Swiss canton, which means a federal state, I guess. And that is the code name for what became Visual Studio Code. Visual Studio Code is the lightweight editor that Microsoft rolled out recently for Mac, Linux, and Windows. And the reason it's codenamed Ticino is kind of interesting is the team that supposedly engineered code
and three,
is based
two more.
In the Microsoft Zurich office.
Well, they probably know how to pronounce it.
They might know how to pronounce it. And I have
and
to say thanks
I
to
Julio
Solutions, one of my Twitter buddies, for that too.
And finally, a beer. Give me beer.
This is a beer Paul Theroux has to find. He would love this beer. It's from Bell's Brewing in Michigan. It's called the Wild One. It's a wild ale / sour beer. And if you know what Flemish red beers are, very similar to that.
Like Chimay red, is that?
Kind of like that, yep. So this is a sour brown ale that they age in oak red wine barrels to make it sour. And the good part is, if you're somebody who's kind of on the fence about drinking sour beers, this is a very nice transitional way to get into sours.
What about some moonshine?
I love sours. Now, I used to hate them. The first time I had one, I was like, ugh, vinegar. But now I love them. This one's really good. It's easy to drink, not too sour. It's got a very nice mellow flavor. And if you're a wine drinker, kind of looking for a beer to bridge you over to, a beer to bridge you over, this would be a good one. Yep.
It's kind of a winey beer.
It is. Good way of putting it. Yeah.
Well, I don't mean to whine, but we've come to the end of the line. I was really hoping that she did install it and it's done. But now I got to paste my Microsoft password.
By the way, I installed the leaked build that came before this on my ThinkPad.
Yeah.
I got Windows Hello support through the finger thing, which is it's pretty sweet.
It's the new sign-on system, Bionic sign-on.
Yeah, it like natively supported it.
You know. Paul, Mary Jo, thank you so much. Paul Theroux at Theroux.com. Theroux.com. Mary Jo's at allaboutmicrosoft.com, and together they form the dynamic duo behind Windows Weekly every Wednesday, 11 a.m. Pacific, 2 p.m. Eastern Time, 1800 UTC. Live.twit.tv.
Live.twit.tv.
Available everywhere, including Spotify. Happy to say that. Please watch every week. Subscribe if you will.
We do.
When does the Spotify thing happen, Leo?
As soon as you get the update to the I take that back because I did get the update to the software on iOS, and I don't see it yet, but it's got the new stuff, so I think it's just going to be a matter of pushing it. We've been uploading the data, the audio video to them for a while, a month or so, just for internal testing, so Should be soon. Yeah, yeah, I'm excited about that. That's 60 million more people that can hear you than your thoughts. Insane as they may be. So that's good. So yeah, if you have the new Spotify, keep your eye peeled for Twit Podcasts on there as well. And of course, Microsoft has the, I think they call it the Xbox Music Store. There's also a podcast app on your Windows phone. It'll be there everywhere, frankly, that you get your shows. That's where we are. Do subscribe so you get everything. Thank you both for being here. We'll see you next time. Yeah, we're excited about that Spotify deal.
Yeah,
that's cool.
I mean, if we know how to get numbers out of it, but that's okay. I don't care. I just want more people to listen. And the more exposure, the better. We're featured very prominently next to Daniel Ek as he made the announcement.
Yeah.
Alright, folks, see you next to Wednesday. Thank you very much.
Alrighty.
Alrighty then. I need a title, my friends, my chatroom friends. Here's the picture of Daniel making the announcement. You see, ABC, ESPN, Fusion, and Twit. Right there. They called us and said, Daniel said you have to. Okay. We can do podcasts on Spotify, but it's got to have Twit. You're right. You're absolutely right. Jeremy, any suggestions for a title? You can shower in my contract. What? Windows sauce? That's what I thought he said, W sauce. slow ringer? I'm a slow ringer. Look great!
Windows.
Five.
ASP. RPG. They still use that, huh? So you come out here, you get a vacation, and you get a little... That's important! We use ADP. Do you work with ADP ever?
This side, and on to this side.
Plate full of tacos that I
assembled hurriedly. Would you like to see? Would you like some?
Here, you got some. Go ahead. Take a bite. Here, we'll get it closer. Closer. Closer.
There you go. Alright. Yeah, it's good. Let's see. I make a good taco. I won't be able to eat it for like 20 minutes, but it's there waiting for me. Okay. We have Kevin Fox on the show today. Oh, hello, hello. Do you hear me?
Hello, I do. How are you?
Always a woman.
Yeah. Nice way to start.
All right, then.
On the show.
Yay.
We have Kevin. Chat.
So. Every time we make one, we have one less to do. One has to try to keep the optimism.
I love it when I walk away from the dock and come back and it's like twice as full.
And there are so many to do.
So I may come and
come up with me and Robert.
He's usually got in through doing the inline. I haven't heard about it this year, so they're doing one they didn't let me know about.
That's, right, that's how you got lost.
Yeah. Well, I sort of got grandfathered in because I suggested it for the first IO.
Oh, neat.
So oh. Since then, they were like, oh, you can come and give a talk.
You're the father.
Well, no, no, Ray's the father.
Based on some Japanese thing, right?
Finnish, I think. Pichikucha.
I think that's Pichikucha. Right. Pichikucha, yeah. So next week I'm going to Facebook on Tuesday, seeing you on Wednesday, IO on Thursday, with Google on Friday. It's great. What are you having for lunch there, Leo?
Oh, some good meatballs.
Every once in a while, my Italian soul cries out for my people's food.
Okay, let's get you. Shut up.
I'm loving MicroPub.
No, I wanted. I'm too well on the show, but I wanted to talk to Jeff about that. Thing about.
I mentioned that I've walked about
it. Short medium.
Yeah.
Well, the thing about editable articles?
No. Will.
No.
No. We'll explain on the show. Embeddable articles is another thing that we could talk about too.
Okay.
I'm looking at micropub.
Well, then one gets tired of looking on all these threads. Then I just take a look on the tree and think we can make a more of those.
So we got FreshBooks, Twig, LegalZoom, Twig.
They end up looking like.
Yeah, just check Braintree. That was the wrong one, so blurring. Letting a new one here. Hey, what are you going to do at Facebook, Jack?
See, I'm talking about news.
You going to give it a talk?
No, just meet people. Which is great. Because all the activity around news right now. Topic of Helsinki. Mm-hmm. Oh, that's right. I get so confused. I can't. Now that I was on Twitter, I think, oh, we already talked about it last week. This is what you're talking about. How do you do this?
Just repeat it. Pretend nobody heard it.
I know, but how do you remember what you
I don't. I have no idea.
We can do Facebook if we want.
I all the time. Where else? Did we talk about this? In fact, I've done it to you. Have I talked about this?
Well, I do it with my students all the time because I have only so many stories. So.
Right.
Did I do that?
Yeah.
Did I talk about that?
I'm trying really hard not to repeat myself in the world because I think that's an old person thing.
Not exactly, same here.
To some extent, but it's also a thing where you're, you find a good way of saying something is worth saying it the same way.
Right. Sweat picture. Proxy certificate.
I'm ready for the ads now.
So see here. Internet, funky.
.com/twig. We'll get there. LegalZoom.com. Off the twig. Braintree payments.
.com/twig.
Twig.
Not twit. Which is what I had.
It's kind of gloomy today, like it's going to rain.
Yeah.
Would you want that?
Yes.
True. You would want much rain.
My desire for rain in the Bay Area is at odds with my love of warm weather.
Sunshine.
But I know we need the rain, so.
According to my watch, it might rain about 3 a.m.
According to my watch, your watch is wrong.
Oop.
You see this watch face?
Let me see. You got a weather watch face. Oh, nice. Oh, I like that. That's a watch face. That's sweet.
Yeah. It's weather underground.
Oh, that's great.
They got a series of them. They've also got like radar ones and things as well.
Oh shit, I'm gonna go get it right now.
Which watch is that?
It's got the old LG.
It's the old LG. Oh. Last year's
freebie. My
Actually, I never got the other one.
You were supposed to get the other 360. That's what Jim gave you.
I never got sent that one.
I'm now sporting the LG Urbane because it's the most up to date.
You've been going back and forth on that.
Yeah, I've been wearing the Apple Watch a lot, trying to give the Apple Watch its due, its fair shake, but I really miss Android. I can't use it on my phone.
Well, hello, good.
It's so primitive. So.
It's also what you're used to. It's hard to shift your brain.
No, I can do that. I do that all the time. But
that's true, you do that.
I'm very used to that. I miss, there's so many features of Android that I miss when I go. Including widgets, but there's even apps I miss, and you know, this for old folks, the S6 is great because it has an adapt sound feature where it gives you a hearing test, and then it EQs the sound based on your hearing to give you.
Really?
Yeah, it's great. It makes a big difference.
what is it adapting though? It's adapting the sound through the ear piece?
Yeah.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah. So. Show you if you want to see it. It's really great. They did this on the Note 4. I think they might have done it on the S5 as well. You know, it's Samsung stuff. It's not. I've seen similar things in other phones. So it's got sound quality and effects, and you can turn on something called Sound Alive, which recreates the effect of rich surround sound. As far as I can tell, it's just kind of
tube amp, which actually makes things a little warmer. But I don't use those, but I do use this, and you can see the curve. I don't know what you can see the curve. But what you do is you go through a hearing test. It's very much like if you've ever had a hearing test from an audiologist, very similar. Where it plays sounds, and you say, if I can hear it, left hand, right hand, that kind of thing. And then this blue line is my hearing, which, as you would expect from an old person, actually, it's excellent. Excellent is here, good is here, and then it goes down.
What's that blue line?
The blue line is my hearing, so it's actually pretty flat. It's low, but it's pretty flat for all the frequencies until you get to the higher frequencies, and it drops off precipitously.
Yeah. That's why you probably leave your turn signal on.
Yeah, I can't hear that thing.
It's even so. This left ear, and that's the right ear, and so.
You run the test yourself on the phone.
Yeah.
Ah, what's this app called? I want this.
It's not an app. It's in Samsung phones. It's in the system.
You mean finally a Samsung thing that you're actually recommending?
Well, wow. It's in the system. I hate to say, there's a lot of customization that Samsung does. It's actually quite. I mean,
really?
The edge screen is stupid, but there's other stuff. First, I really like it that I can have a slideshow of my lock screen, so my lock screen has different images. Every half hour, there's a different image. The fingerprint reader on the is really good.
That was the thing I liked about the Facebook Home thing, which I'm sure they kept up. That was actually pretty.
And there are third-party lock screens that do that, but this is part of Samsung.
I'm not sure where it came from.
I use it. I don't use the normal.
I'm looking at the launcher now.
I miss widgets when I go to the iPhone. I just feel like the ability just to look on the screen and see things like the weather, and, you know, my calendar, my front page of my phone, it has the time, date, weather, and calendar right here in the square. And I miss that when I'm using my phone. I have to watch an app to find out what's going on.
Well, that's why I like this watch.
Yeah, the watch is helpful for that.
The weather with a little graph.
Right.
I do like the idea of little graphs on the watch face. That's cool.
And then I'm using a MicroPub app here called MobilePub. It's great, so I don't have to post to Known directly. I can use this app to post. Yeah. Although there's still an issue with Known and audio, because what I'm really looking for is a way to record quick audio and video and put it up on the site.
The hard part is you have to encode it locally.
It doesn't understand 4A's for some reason. I don't get that, but.
Oh, Known doesn't?
No. So it might be a MIME issue, I don't know what it is. Ben's aware of it. Aware of it. It's always been an issue. That's disappointing, because I would love to be able to, but I can, but there's now a MicroPub that will suck the pictures from my Instagram, so when I post on Instagram now, it goes to my Known site, which is nice.
Yeah.
I figure, Known is going to do as good a job as anybody in that area. So, this is so indie.
Yeah.
So I like
jet lag.
Actually, I ended up paying.
I'm running on a screen. Do I need to add in there?
Jeff, I don't know if it's possible to back the camera away slightly. I don't know if it's closer than normal or.
It was. I just pulled my keyboard up. How's that?
That is better.
It seems to be too much daylight.
Should I put some things in front of the window?
Yeah. If you flag that down, then the auto wipe down, the auto what's it will help.
Yeah, the auto what's it. It'll be better. Why,
You used to have controllers for that, but it's easy to turn that off now with all the.
Yeah, we use an app called a webcam. So, Jason, can you still see my screen when I choose this resolution?
My dog's back. Hello, dogs.
Yes.
Got it.
Good. And it's not cut off. No. Okay,
now so I have it using it.
Yeah, it's working. So I can't read it. When it adjusts for you, it goes to much higher resolution. I can't read it. Yes, we'll be using Tone today.
So this is one of my favorite things, old things I have.
Let's see the close-up of Jeff. It's his Chromebook chirping. It's,
Yeah.
All right, listen, because I am going to tone. Well, it wouldn't do any good if you don't have tone installed. The tone page. But if you've already got tone, you don't need to. The tone can't hear itself. I don't know why it cares about that.
What's tone? So, yeah.
What's tone?
Oh. What's tone? Oh, we got him.
Got him. Something Kevin Mox did.
Yeah, something
so bad.
Word on the show today.
I love things. This, I like to do that.
So, is that a
wrap? It's an extension. It's from Google. Yeah.
Extension to the phone. To the browser?
Not to the phone, to the Chrome.
To the Chrome? All right.
But it'll work on your Chromebook. So, the birds are chirping URLs as well. So, we're so excited because Spotify is adding a tweet on other podcasts. Using tone on your browser, you've got your speakers turned on while you listen to the show, and I press this button, your Chrome will automatically go to this page.
Alright, I gotta stall it so
it's
not
there is so much ever.
There was so much potential for bad things with this.
No, they so, say they say very clearly it doesn't do any authentication or anything, it just opens a URL.
Well, the problem is, of course, I'm listening to you through my headset, not through
speakers.
I'm not gonna do it.
And I have to make sure that the TriCaster volume is turned up. We did this a few years ago.
Yeah, we did.
With chirp.io. Remember that?
Yeah. Right.
And but their chirps were not nearly as sonorous.
Well, the first QuickTime broadcaster we built had a send a URL feature in it.
Right.
In 1980.
Right. QuickTime was very good at that kind of thing.
And then we realized it wasn't a problem.
Yeah, we're sending
so
URL.
We took it out again.
Yeah.
So that was the chirp.
This is, here it is, this is the sound. This will send you to chirp.io, which was the originator of this. But this is now somebody else. It looks like a pivot. Well, it does say it sings information from one phone to the other. It's gone phone, though. Chirp for Chrome is getting here. But your browser's chirping. I wonder if Google, they didn't acquire that. Like they say, tone was written in an hour or two. As like a hack. Chirp for Chrome is here.
Like so many good things.
Yeah. Yeah, the best stuff, right? So I could have double. I can. Oh boy, I can.
I wonder if they both interpret the chirps similarly.
Well, you want to hear it? Here's
each other's language.
Here's this is tone. And for the same page, this is chirp. Today we're announcing an exciting little experiment, Chirp for Chrome. I know. I just installed it. Much more annoying.
Yeah, very different. Yeah.
Sounds like
R2. But it's so much more sci-fi, though.
But it sounds like R2-D2, doesn't it?
Yeah, exactly. Are you going to watch Letterman tonight?
We're having a party here. We're going to take the East Coast feed.
Wow.
Actually, let's do the show, because I do want to mention Letterman.
Yeah. I'm gonna put up. I scanned my two letters from Dave.
This is a very sad day for me.
Same here. You were never on the show, were you?
No, I wish. I went to see it once.
I'll tell the story online.
They you go and you wait in the lobby, like at 2 p.m. of the Ed Sullivan Theater. People are there right now, of course. And then PAs come out with clipboards and jolly you up. They want to see if you like are fun. And then they make notes. They say, you go on this line. And then a guy comes up and says, Leo. I said, yeah. You go on that line. That line, the people in the at the bottom, in the front, are all the people who are
like, jolly.
That line they sent me to is for the industry for people. They would put you way up in the balcony because they know you're not. Yeah, they know you're not going to be cheering or anything. So they put you up in the balcony. But it was awesome to see. I've seen both Carson and Letterman live,
wow.
And I will cherish those memories. It was incredible. It is like he's dying, Lepton. It's exactly like he's dying. Because remember Carson? They said, "Oh yeah, Carson will be doing stuff." No, he went on, got this boat. That was it. Never heard from him again.
Sad.
next time for This Week at Google. Hello, everybody. Leo Laporte here with Mr. Jeffrey Jarvis from the CUNY Labs in beautiful downtown New York, New York.
Meatballs make you mellow. It's a very mellow beginning.
I am mellow. I've been eating meatballs. No, you know why I'm mellow? Well, we'll talk about it in a second. Let me introduce Kevin. Kevin Marks is also here. We love Kevin from his garden. The chirping birds signal the arrival of spring. Or of the new tone extension. Or Chrome. Hi, Kevin. Kevin, a Googler, an Appler, a British telecommer, a Salesforcer, and now he's
out Gartner.
And now Indie.
Now Indie. Indie Web is
Indie
his,
Web, yes.
Is a
Indie.
Wonderful thing. We're going to talk a little bit about some Indie Web stuff. But the reason I'm a little mellow, I'm not merely mellow, I'm kind of sad because this is Letterman's last night. And boy, I just, I remember Carson's last night. I remember Bette Midler saying, one for my baby, one for the road. I just,
it's the end of the, you know, Carson was the comic model of my father's generation.
Yes.
Letterman for my, our generation.
Our generation. Very much.
And I would argue Jon Stewart for some
yes,
days.
Yes, I think you're right.
But Letterman definitely was the voice we tried to emulate in comedy.
Yeah.
And then telling a joke and a story and an attitude. And he changed, you know, he just did so much. He, you know, I feel bad to this day about the whole Leno thing, but in the end, I think what today disproves right now is that he won in the end.
I think so.
He's much more respected, much more loved, much more of an innovator. Leno turns out to be a low-heart buffoon, bore, lump of nasty humanity.
I'm kind of with you. And it's funny, because Dave's known for being kind of cranky and snarky and sarcastic. But there was this, just as with Johnny, there was an undercurrent of kind of Midwest, good old boy, nice guy.
And the thing about, I think Dave started was and this is Howard Stern for me too, is honesty.
Yes.
Leno was just one big fake.
It was showbiz. He was the old showbiz, and that's what Letterman was an antidote to in the 80s and the 90s.
Absolutely.
Was to that whole showbiz thing. He always kind of, you know, deprecated that and hated it.
So I just put up two letters that Dave sent me when I was a TV critic. These are my most prized possessions.
Where'd you put them?
Under a short tweet. Oh. They're very minor, but they are my absolute prized possessions.
Right.
Find it?
Under other as a tweet. Okay, there you go. It's on the. Oh, you mean on the Twitter?
There's a Twitter tweet.
Yeah. What did he say?
So he said. I just wanted to thank you for saying such nice things about me. I appreciate the support. This is when he was going through the Leno fight, losing the Tonight Show.
It kind of blows me that was 22 years ago.
Isn't it amazing?
Blows me away. Right.
I was like, what? That was NBC letterhead. This is CBS letterhead. Just thanking me for reviewing the show. That's not your friend, Dave. He hated critics. He wouldn't even let us into the show.
Yeah.
But there was what we weren't allowed in. Despised us. But it's still, I have such respect for him. And to have gotten within a mile of this is amazing. So I'm missing Dave. Even though I was too old to stay up late to watch you.
Oh yeah, well that's the sad story, is none of us watched it.
Now who watches Jimmy or watch them all on John Oliver and John Stewart?
Yeah.
Not even Petivo. We watched them
on demand.
The best bits on YouTube.
On YouTube, yeah.
Yeah.
I must admit I'm being quiet here because I barely watch any of these things. I only had the loosest idea of the letter. I don't understand the cultural.
Well, that's the deal. Yeah, I mean, Carson really was the kind of show where everybody watched it and then you kind of wanted to talk about it the next morning, right? It was a water cooler conversation. And so, for some reason, it really was must watch, even though it was really late at night. But I think that the habit of late night television viewing kind of died out. Probably thanks to TiVo and VHS.
I mean, Jimmy and Jimmy are both good. They're both wonderful. But what young person watches anything scheduled?
Right. Nobody. I didn't. Thank God that saved Saturday Night Live because usually only one or two good skits. So the fact that you just watch a clip really saves you hours of wasted time every week. I'm gonna miss John Stewart. I think, what's his last show, or did he already have it?
No, it's coming up.
I think I'll have the same kind of feeling, although,
yeah.
For our generation, because Letterman was on for 33 years, he's really for our, I mean, we started watching in our 20s, right? So that's really why it means so much, I think, to our generation. When Conan retires, you guys will understand. Colbert's taking over. I think that's going to be interesting. Is he going to be Colbert or Colbert?
Colbert.
So he will keep
without the Colbert character.
Without the character. I'm dying to see what he's like without the character.
I think he'll be good. I was talking about Jake last night. He's a little nervous about it, but I think he's very good. I mean, Jake, thanks to Jake, I went to see the show, and he does the, you know, the pre.
He's clever. He's smart. Oh, I love Conan. He started with Letterman. And then, of course, John Oliver, who is the dark horse who surprised everybody, except me, because I listened to his Bugle podcast for years.
Yeah.
The funniest podcast ever.
Too.
And so I knew that Oliver was a gem, although I was a little disheartened when HBO so blatantly copied The Daily Show.
Yes.
No, I think he's found his niche.
It's different. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because it's weekly, and it's actually almost a documentary show, which is very interesting.
Yeah. He takes on a big topic, and which is risky, because most of the topics really work. His school testing one was great, but not everyone is the gem, and he's committed to doing, you know, a 12-minute gem. It's hard.
It's hard, but boy, he's made a big difference in our world.
Yeah.
I think give him credit to turning around the net neutrality conversation.
Yep. And he gave one of patterns, software patterns,
he's taken on some big sacred cows. The piece he did on testing a couple of weeks ago, I hope, made people aware of what is going on in education in the United States. It's not good. It's not good at all. I love the birds. They're really, they're active. Must be mating season. That's not chirp. That's cap.
Wait. Except that we've had the nests have hatched. There weren't nests in our...
We need some cats to cut down the pump.
Oh, we've got a cat. Cats nearby.
I've got cats and dogs and birds here, so
it's
the entire Tom and Jerry show.
Next week, Jeff will be in studio with us because he's coming to town. Google I.O. starts a week from tomorrow.
Okay.
And already some rumors. According to Bloomberg, Google will be unveiling a new photo service separated from Google Plus. This would be just another nail in Google Plus's coffin. It makes me sad. I was sad when Buzz closed.
When I was at Newsgeist in Helsinki, which is a news thing that Google did to just lose some squeaky wheels in Europe. It's Googlers and it's news people, and I did my standard joke about how, you know, I still like Google Plus. It always gets a laugh. It is a constant laugh line now.
I like it. I do too. And I like it more because there's fewer people there. It turns out, I realized that really this, I like social networks when it's just people like me. And as soon as normal people get in there, it's like, come on, I don't need any more algorithm posts. And you're starting to see that Google Plus. You're starting to see that same kind of Facebook resharing of, you know, garbage. And that to me is not going to be good for any social network. Such as Twitter has gone post that. Now Twitter is something completely different. I don't know what Twitter is, but it's something completely different. So the new photo tool, which will let users, according to Bloomberg, post images to Facebook and Twitter.
Yay, at last.
Finally. Will greater autonomy, photo tool, more freedom to take on rivals. In other words, because Facebook and Twitter were seen as competitors to Google Plus, couldn't share to them.
I thought there was some mutual bad luck there as well.
Yeah, that's probably true.
The other thing that's changed, was announced, was that Google is indexing Twitter again, which is another one of these strategy tax things that they've done. I think there was that was at least partly Google and partly Twitter. But the fact they couldn't come to agreement on that was a big shame. I suspect that was infighting within Google as well.
Yeah, because Google had the fire hose, then Twitter turned it off, I think, where they couldn't come to an agreement.
Well, they had Google
And then they couldn't make a deal on the fire hose. Twitter asked for too much money. Google got too grumpy. Something. Or there was some Google Plus actually tax in. That's quite possible. That's part of it too. And so that ended up with them getting rid of Google real-time search completely, which was a shame, because that was actually a useful thing. I don't know if you remember using that, but it was something quite helpful. And
if someone's going to act irrationally these days, I'm going to bet it's Twitter over Google.
No, I think there's, you know, we can see some of this as Plus is being de-emphasized, that there was definitely some strategy tech stuff coming from there as well. Certainly with this photos discussion and with the Twitter photos thing as well, there was definitely a we should be using our thing, not their thing, from the Plus group. Now I suspect that wasn't what the search group wanted, and that ended up being one of those internal infighting things, because otherwise, you know, why would they have got rid of the real time search thing if the goal was to put Google Plus in the real time search?
So how do I get this new thing? Do I search for? I see on Search Engine Land the story there was hashtag.
You have to search it from mobile, apparently.
Oh, it doesn't work from desktop.
What the report said was that it's mobile only at the moment, and I wasn't sure if it's everywhere yet.
Oh, let me try it on my search.
Hashtag iZombie.
Well, let me do hashtag David Letterman, because that's trending right now on Twitter, so presumably there'd be a lot of content there. Letterman. I hate having this. So do you have to use a hashtag if you're going to do this search to get the carousel?
I've only seen the examples. So
here we go. Popular on Twitter. Here's the carousel. Yeah.
Okay.
Interesting. So that's above the normal search.
That's
results.
A very high placement. Wow.
Yeah. Well, you don't get much higher than that. It's number one.
No, but it's also a lot of real estate.
Yeah. Look at this. And you get a follow link. Can you zoom in a little bit? I think it's hard to read right now. Camera's too far away, but you get at the bottom, you get a follow link that says more tweets for David Letterman. So it's popular on Twitter, and then you get this carousel, and these are this is James and Carla Murray. It's just somebody on Twitter.
But this is this weirdly curated, very KR.
I need to run a second.
Here we go. Wait a minute. So if I scroll down far enough, there's NBC, there's
save, whatever
right.
That means.
Yeah, that's why I used David Letterman. That was a trending topic, so I knew that would.
Right.
It's kind of pointy.
So you'd want to use the trending topic.
It's interesting, but it also implies that there is a strong time component, because I imagine that would be higher last night.
I, for one, wasn't crazy about the idea of including tweets in search results, because tweets are kind of unpredictable.
Well, as we just saw.
Right. So I feel like, I don't know, is that really what I want when I go a search? Maybe, I mean,
I don't think that, I think that not that prominent. I think it's kind of a, like a side one box, maybe.
Right. Google researchers create amazing time lapses from public photos. This is kind of an auto-awesome thing, but not to photos uploaded to Google, but wow. This is kind of a public domain. A team from Google and the University of Washington have created it's a completely automated way to create time lapse videos. They scour through Flickr and Picasa and other photo sharing sites. They sort them by geographic location, looking for widely snapped landmarks.
Oh yeah, this is amazing.
Order the photos by date, and then obviously you have to then modify the photos so that everything matches up. And
the video below is a creeping ice there.
Time lapse. photos.
Yes.
It's going to go through.
So all these people take pictures of glaciers, right? They have to color correct and match. And then you can actually see the glacier melting. Wow. Wow. That's really neat. I mean, it's not a good thing, but here's the building we just saw. And you can see it when you see the timeline, all the images they're using. Holy cow.
What computers can do.
It's amazing.
This is interesting. It's like the thing Microsoft did, but in time rather than in space.
They did PhotoSynth, which, yeah, made a 360 out of multiple pictures.
From multiple people.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas this is doing it across time. Which is, that's a very nice piece of work. I like that.
Thank you, science.
Yeah, I mean, also, was that an annual cycle of the glacier, or was that... The same
that was for 2,000 years.
Okay.
Glaciers
like the growing trick every year.
Yeah. But over 10 years, I think that's more
significant.
It's definitely a trend.
Because years ago, when I was doing multimedia stuff, one of the things we did was a thing called Herzicht, which was an exhibition in a museum where we did time lapse stuff, but it was all satellite time lapse stuff. And that we had polarized cameras, ozone rays, stuff like that. For a long time too. But it's great to see ground up based stuff.
You merge,
it's obviously, even if you've got a satellite, it stays in the same place.
You merge big data, the fact that we now store everything and it's all kind of accessible, with computation. Some pretty sophisticated computation. It's very interesting what you can get. It's not just the one, it's not just having big data, it's being able to parse it, to massage it,
right.
Get something out of it. Maps was hacked again.
Oh, badly.
By jerky jerks. I thought Google had fixed this. Boy, this is shocking. It's not like exactly peeing on an iPhone. This happened yesterday. So Google, which had said we are going to change the who we let change maps and so forth.
We lose the opportunity to get people to contribute to
so sad.
Public knowledge.
There's trolls everywhere. Jeez,
this is an indexing thing rather than a labeling thing.
Oh, so it's using a different searching for a particular phrase. So this is kind of poop.
And let's see where it puts you.
Right.
And for mine, it puts me with Tante, apparently.
What a surprise. That's probably accurate. So wait a minute, so you search maps for your Twitter handle.
Yes.
And since Twitter is, if you turn it on, and I do, telling, I'm right here.
So yeah, you are quite likely to be accurate, because...
I told you that with the location turned on, so it does.
Right. But a lot of other people are finding very, very, very strange ones. There's somebody was collecting them.
Let's try Jeff Jarvis, see where does Jeff live?
Do that.
Good for you, Jeff.
Yeah. This is going to freak people out. Watch, I'm counting down. I just started the countdown clock to freak out in Germany.
What? Freak out in Germany? Why? What's going on?
They pinpointed where I am.
Well,
we didn't exactly where
yeah,
you are.
Yeah, you already tweeted that. Let's see where Jason is. You're here, Jason.
A little off.
So this is the nearest, is this the nearest, the most recent tweet in time, or is it based on all your tweets?
I'm not quite sure what it's based on, because...
You're not with Tentec now.
Some of things are getting very strange results. Like, they were searching for Ed Miliband MP and getting,
You're not with Tentec in the San Francisco at the panel
yeah,
right now. So it's not your most recent. But do you have geolocation turned on?
I turn on and off.
Let's see where POTUS is. Oh, he's at the White House.
Did you get that right? Okay, so maybe they haven't iterated this a bit.
You're just messed up. Dr. Mom says she's, let's see, is it Dr. Mom on Twitter, Dr. Mom? I should be. She's no, that's a company called Dr. Mom Presentations. That's not you.
Is there an underscore in there somewhere? Though?
Yeah, I put the underscore. What, Dr. Mom, what's your Twitter handle? Between when she hears this and she can put that in. Oh well, she's in our chat room right now. That's kind of interesting. Is that related to the Google Twitter relationship? It is not.
I'm not sure. I think this was a meme with this instead of I think we're searching for politicians like strange things, especially UK ones, where they're turning up in very odd places.
POTUS, of course, is President Clinton. Will be President Clinton's account, I think. Did you see Bill Clinton tweeting? So Barack Obama tweets from at POTUS.
Great.
Finally, after 6 years, they've given me my own Twitter account. Bill Clinton, what does Clinton ask? He says, so is it yours or does it pass on to the next owner? I've got
the house.
I've
yeah.
got, that, does it go with the house? I've got an eye at somebody, a candidate in mind.
and Obama comes back and says, I don't know, but is somebody interested in the FLOTUS?
Because of course Clinton will be the first gentleman we've learned, by the way.
Is that what it is?
Yeah. There's a question, Bill Clinton. The handle comes with the house. No, anyway.
So he will be FDOTUS.
FDOTUS, yeah.
I wonder if they reserve that.
I wonder. Well, how come POTUS was available?
Well, because Twitter has the ability to keep people off.
So they kept people off of that one. Hoping someday.
Yes, FDOTUS has been assigned.
Huh? There you go. First guy. That's the kind of does dual purpose. It could be first gentleman or first guy.
Oh, among those walking into Letterman's finale, Jerry Seinfeld, Chris Rock, Steve Martin, Tina Fey, Alec Baldwin, Jim Carrey, Peyton Manning.
Oh my. Oh my, oh my. That's a pretty good lineup.
Yeah, it is.
Let's take a break. When we come back, we got more. We got Kevin Marks and the Birds.
Oh, good.
We got Jeff Jarvis and the Lettuce. And we got here in the Brick House, FreshBooks. FreshBooks was a lifesaver for me when I was a freelancer still and sending invoices, or not, truthfully, not sending invoices at the end of the month. I couldn't bring myself to... Oh, it was such a pain. I had my invoices in Microsoft Word. I wasn't using Excel. It wasn't that sophisticated. It's just a pain. Every day, every month on the 30th, I'm supposed to make my invoices, send them off. And this, the problem was, if you don't make your invoices, you don't get paid. Fortunately, Amber MacArthur knew about FreshBooks. This is when I was going to Toronto one week to show up there. Had to bill Rogers, not only for my visits, but for expenses, for hotel and meals and airfare. And that's just such a pain. She told me about FreshBooks, what a lifesaver it was. First of all, I immediately designed a good-looking invoice that could be emailed. It made it easy for me to fill out and just physically make an invoice. It meant I got paid faster. In fact, on average, FreshBooks users get paid 5 days faster. Partly because the invoice has a pay me button, which lets your client use credit cards and almost all the payment methods online. And the truth is, clients do want to pay you. It's just a much pain in the butt for them to do the check as it is for you to send the invoice. So make it easy for them, make it easy for you. Get paid faster, it's the greatest. And, incidentally, with the FreshBooks apps, you can capture and manage your expenses, take pictures of the receipts, track your billable hours. It's so cool. to support rock stars. Getting started is easy. It's totally free for your first month. No obligation. You're going to love it. Go to freshbooks.com/twig. Stop doing this manually, please. Do yourself a favor. Come tax time. Your accountant will appreciate it, too, because the reports are great. Freshbooks.com/twig. And where they say, how'd you hear about us? Just put TWIG. Start your 30-day free trial today. Freshbooks.com/twig. Use twig as the where you hear about us reference. Thank you so much for your support, Freshbooks. And thank you for making my life a lot easier for many, many years. Self-driving cars hit the road. Let's hope they don't hit pedestrians in Mountain View this summer, Google said. We're going to put them out there. The speed will be capped at 25 miles an hour. And, you know, it's going to be those little weird Tonka toy rounded little cars that Google showed that have no steering wheel, no accelerator, no brake, but that's illegal. So Google's going to put temporary steering wheel, brakes, and accelerator in there along with a human.
That's like being the monkey on the first Sputnik.
Very similar. It's like that barely fit like of the dog in that thing.
There's no reason for me to be here.
I don't know. See, if you were in a self-driving car, would you? I feel like we talked about this on Twitter on Sunday.
Google employee who has
that's even getting you bring a sandwich something.
I'm not working for Google. What are you doing, son? I'm sitting in a car all day.
Braden. They said this. Do you think they designed these because this is the right design for this car, or just to make people feel better? Like, Asimo, the Sony robot that looks like a small human.
Oh, that's very Chroma Pixel.
That light?
Light bar on the side, yeah.
Do you think when it hits somebody, it pulses red?
It looks up your name and
I am sorry, I'm in jail. So they'll be going through neighborhoods. This is not going to be on highways. They've been doing about 10,000 miles a week. A million autonomous miles on the road. 10,000 autonomous miles a week.
It's self-driving golf cart, isn't it?
It looks like that. I want a real car.
It's about the same speed and power as those, and may actually therefore be legal in those terms.
Maybe it is.
One of the reasons it's that shape.
So cute. There's no human in that one.
It also looks less resistant to being crashed into by a random passers-by than the previous Priuses.
There have been since September, 4 accidents, but in every case, Google says they were low speed, under 10 miles an hour, and it was the human's fault, not the driver's fault, or the car's fault.
So I just put in the rundown, Chris Sacca,
Cowboy shirt.
Saka. Is doing an AMA in Periscope, yeah.
And I got one. I had a friend, James Cham, who at the time was a half
subordinate.
I know, I'm
too.
Shouldn't it be sideways? Doesn't it?
You could turn it sideways, I think, but we asked Ben Rubin, the founder of Meerkat, why Meerkat, when it first came out, forced you really to do portrait mode. He said, because that's native to the phone.
Yeah, if you're watching it on the phone, it makes sense. It's one of those.
Yeah, it only looks bad on a desktop. You go, why am I looking through it? Especially with this particular shot where it gets half cut off.
It's
it's a one and a half shot.
They should like lean in from opposite sides of the frame. Like, this is the eternal problem of TV, which is what shape should it be?
Yeah, not that shape. Somebody said, your eyes, you have two eyes. It should be, turn that on its side so you can use your two eyes. I think when you're looking at a phone, that makes perfect sense. I don't have any problem with that. But it doesn't work for this particular thing. So, why should we care that Saka's doing a Periscope? Is there some excitement? Are you you know what they did Periscope? The Spotify announcement this morning. The Spotify announcement was not streamed publicly in New York. Press were invited. And Mashable, I think, or Fast Company, decided to Periscope it.
Oh.
Interesting, huh?
Spotify announced that they are going to do an updated app. This is, you know what's happening here? Is everybody, the same thing happened before the watch came, the Apple Watch came out. Everybody is trying to get their end of the news cycle before Apple announces its streaming music service, WWDC. So Spotify is going to do video, which is a big, big deal. And they are also going to feature podcasts, including ours.
So this
show and all of the Twitch programs will be available, audio and video, on Spotify.
That's really interesting.
And
so they have any cost to you? They're hosting them?
Oh yeah, no
any
cost to us. I don't know what the deal is. We might get rid of it. I don't know. I don't think so because they're not modifying, they're not putting ads in it or anything. They don't do ads. Nor are they taking our ads out though. So they also announced a new feature which I really like. If you're a runner, they'll automatically make a playlist that matches your cadence as you run because the phone knows you.
Jesus, I'll get a viral dirt.
Jeff, you're not running great, but he says it's like dancing. You wouldn't dance to music that didn't match. You wouldn't dance, you know, one way and have the music be different. So it makes sense. So yeah, we're thrilled to be part of that. We knew about it because we had to provide them with content, make sure it worked and all that stuff. So if you're a Spotify subscriber, good news. Along with all the great music, you'll be able to listen to Twink. Or Twink, this show.
Twink, please Twink. No.
Russia threatens to ban Google and Twitter and Facebook over extremist content. There is a move afoot. Not just in Russia, look at Great Britain, to mark some kinds of speech so threatening that it's going to be blocked. I hope we don't get to that situation.
Sure. I mean, I agree. But it's also, I think, just the nearest excuse to try to ban these things that threaten tyrants.
Well, that's really the real reason. They want to ban it, Russia says, over extremist content, illegal activities. It's that bloggers law that they passed. The 2014 legislation requires popular bloggers in Russia to register their real identity with the authorities. Oy, oy, oy. That's... Oy, oy, oy.
But they did that a while ago, right?
Right, that was last year.
Yeah.
So they're going to use that, though, to also regulate social media. And of course, David Cameron, we talked about this last week, said in Great Britain
very depressing.
That, if you're, it was actually such a depressing quote because it sounded like 1984.
I can't believe that he said that. It was shocking. He said,
let me see if I can find it. Yeah, because
up to now, we've said that as long as you obey the law, we won't bomb. But that got to change.
We've been a passively tolerant society for too long. For too long, we've been a passively tolerant society saying to our citizens, as long as you obey the law, we'll leave you alone.
Is this Putin or Cameron?
This is David Cameron! This government will conclusively turn the page on this failed approach. As the party of one nation, we will govern as one nation and bring our country together. This is like nationalism to the extreme.
Yep. Yeah. Well, one nation has a different nuance in the UK, but it does sound like...
Oh, it does? Okay.
Yeah, well, there's a notion of one nation Toryism, which, as opposed to division between rich and poor. So that's what he's drawing on there. But yeah, from the outside, it does sound like Ayn Rand, which is...
Yeah, I vote. And if you say anything against us, well, that's your problem.
Wow. But it is a pretty, pretty bad departure. The open rights group in the UK is sort of ramping up, working how to deal with this, seeing how they can respond.
Because what is the reaction in the UK?
Not in the UK, so only see what I see through social media. But it was widely heralded as a shocking thing.
Yeah,
but it is also, the other half of it is that it is also a shout out to the long run orbital wing of his party into the UKIP ground as well. That's the other piece of this. And it is a...
That's kind of, to me, it sounds like the UKIP rhetoric, the very highly nationalistic rhetoric.
Well, that, UKIP was very, very shocking for the Conservatives because they won the majority, won the most seats in the European Parliament last year. Because the European Parliament is done by...
And they got one seat in this election?
Party list PR, whereas the election is done by first past the post. They got one seat, yes, but they got 5 million votes or something. So they did affect a lot of results by moving votes around the way things work in the UK. And it worked out in the Conservatives' favour, mostly, I think, because they managed to persuade some of the UK voters to swing back to them rather than vote Labour. But it was a shock result. The pollsters had no idea what was going on because of all these different parties and their model of left-right didn't fit anymore. But it was also this sort of, there is now this sort of, UKIP has moved the rhetoric such that there is this very, very strong anti-immigration tone, anti-immigration policy, which that sounds very British to me. But then, I've been away for a while, so it's hard to get that now.
It feels like nationalism is growing, and nationalism in Europe has always been a problem. There's a history. There's a bad history. Google wants to put buy buttons on its search result pages in the coming weeks.
This is a slap at Amazon, isn't it?
Yeah, it's like a one-click. Google said, well, Google doesn't say anything. This is from the Wall Street Journal.
Right.
But the idea is that the buttons, when you do a search, again on mobile, this is mobile, will accompany sponsored search results or paid search results. You might see, according to this article, a shop on Google heading at the top of the page. The button, though, will not drive you to Google, but drive you to the sponsor, to the advertising.
Which will still have Europe go berserk, because that's been the essence of the fight. That is the essence of the antitrust.
Right.
Is Google a shopping source? So Google putting a bit of a poke in the eye, though I'm fine with that.
Google won't show buy buttons when shoppers search on desktop computers. Just...
Why not?
On mobile. I think they figure it doesn't matter on desktop. Where they're really facing the battle is in mobile search, right?
But if it's a user, I don't think that it's still the same user, and treat me as a user appropriately across all platforms.
What's good for the mobile is good for the game.
Yeah, it's supposed to.
That's a good point. And it's kind of an inconsistent user experience, that one.
Right.
And I don't mind a buy button. I mean, it's already an ad. All it's doing is giving me a way to act upon it.
But here's what I'm hoping. Google's promoting its advertisers over neutral listings of shopping services. Yeah, it is. It's called capitalism.
But I don't think they're going to complain. Because this is in paid advertising, not a search results.
That was the same problem as Google's promoting its paid advertisers. That's the essence of the suit, of the investigation.
Now, where do you guys come down on...
What? Which suit is this? I missed the presidential lawsuit on it.
There's not a lawsuit. There was proposed action by the. Oh no! Wait a minute. They investigated.
Oh, it's the antitrust.
It's the antitrust.
Exactly. That's all. Yeah, they're going after them. They'll charge them 6% of their revenue.
You didn't hear about that one? That's a good one.
Well, it might help pay off Greece's debt.
Probably would.
Yeah.
Internet.org and the EFF. We talked last week about Zuckerberg. You're going to Facebook on Tuesday. You can ask Mark about this.
Yeah.
Internet.org is not just Facebook and others. It's a way to bring the internet to undeveloped nations with the support of Facebook and others, and it would give them kind of a special version of the internet. Remember, we Mark Zuckerberg addressed that it wasn't net neutral. EFF now has published an article. Internet.org is not neutral, not secure, that's a new argument, and not the internet. Internet.org offers people from developing countries free mobile access to selected websites. And has been pitched as a philanthropic initiative to connect 2/3 of the world who don't yet have internet access. EFF says, we agree that global digital divide should be closed, but is this the right way to do it?
So what is the right way? That's Zuckerberg's point, is that you can't give away the whole internet for free. not going to work. There are commercial interests here. They opened it up to more than Facebook. The original rumor was it was going to be Facebook for free.
Well,
so
it was Facebook and Wikipedia. Wikipedia was the big lead.
Wikipedia, that's right. That's right.
Big lead. Well done.
Yeah.
all that inaccurate Wikipedia stuff.
You got Wikipedia. Now, if they did WikiLeaks, then I'd be impressed.
Yeah. So they opened up for more, and so what do you prefer? I certainly get the argument. I'm all net neutrality, but does the fundamentalism go too far if it prevents something here? So I think that this is I'm not going to whatever to do it again. This is kind of the argument I had with Matthew Raper, is when you say, well, I just don't like that. Stop, take a deep breath, and say, well, what are the terms that might make you like it? What are the principles that you would expect Facebook to accede to? That would make this acceptable to bring free internet to a lot more people. Are there any other circumstances in which you could imagine that happening? That's the conversation we ought to have. And I think it's something about Facebook being open to other services, of which they're doing. I don't know what the limitations are. Is it too limited? Let's get into the arguments. Or are you just saying that no, Facebook cannot give away free internet access full stop?
Well, but get ready for this. You can debate that, and maybe reasonable. Get this.
I'm unreasonable, so that's
right.
One
no, I'm on your side of that one, but maybe you can make an argument, hey, better that than nothing. But internet.org prevents encrypted HTTPS connections. It's a proxy server. Traffic must pass through, and some devices, like Android phones, that have the technical ability to make encrypted connections through the proxy server, will be prevented from doing that. Internet.org's Android app can automatically bring up the interstitial warning directly on the phone by using the app to analyze links. And more importantly, traffic must pass for phones. Okay, the most inexpensive feature phones that can't run an Android app don't support phone-based warnings that would say, hey, this is not a safe connection, it's not encrypted. For these phones, traffic must pass through Internet.org's proxy unencrypted, which means any information users send or receive from internet.org services can be read by local police or national intelligence agencies.
What do you imagine the rationale for that?
It's because these are low-end phones. I'm not sure of what the...
It's also because it's very hard to proxy HTTP. Yes, because it's
right.
A point-based HTTP, yes.
Right.
Yes.
Because in order to proxy, you have to man in the middle, whereas you can proxy HTTP because it's the plain text.
And so, Kevin, you have to proxy this because that's the only way to make it free, because it's a free connection versus a paid connection.
I think it's a rewriting proxy. I think that's my understanding of it. So it's
here's the deal.
Transforming the pages.
Let me read this. Plans, blah blah blah, with the guide announcement, will be reviewed by internet.org team, which may make the site available. There's a compliance standard, guidelines. Any website operator can submit their site for inclusion in internet.org, provided it meets the guidelines. Those guidelines are neutralized to subject matter, but do impose technical limitations intended to ensure the sites don't overly burden the carrier's network, and that they'll work on inexpensive feature phones as well as modern smartphones. The site is then routed through the internet.org proxy server, which allows the sites to be zero rated by participating mobile phone operators, allows the automatic stripping out of content that violates the guidelines. That includes images bigger than a megabyte, videos, VoIP calls.
Oh, that's why it has to go through the proxy.
Right.
So you can do that filtering.
It's going
to
strip out Flash, Java applets, even JavaScript, and inserts an interstitial warning if a user attempts to leave internet.org's zero rated portion of the internet. In other words, you've got this for free, but if you leave this, you're going to be billed for data charges. So you still have access, in some cases, to a broader internet, but you'll get billed for that, whereas internet.org is free.
Right. I mean, to some extent, did you remember the proxy?
Yeah.
/TWT/N. So that was an old one they wrote a few years back for when mobile browsers were really crap. And it takes your web pages and strips them down into a nice lean version. And it works. It does a fairly good job of making sense of the pages, but it will rewrite the HTML. It will dump out the styling and the scripts. It will make smaller versions of the image. You know, that sort of thing. It's a way of getting some kind of rendition of the page on a mobile connection. So they're all is doing something similar to that. And to some extent, so is the new Facebook Instant Pages thing is doing something similar to that. It's reading the HTML and rendering it a different way. And there's you can argue this in different directions. So you can say providing proxy can be a useful thing because it's, to some extent, the ability is that some of the reader type apps do that. They'll make a more stripped down version of the page. It's easy for you to make sense of. But it's stripping out things that the sending site put there for a reason. In another sense, that is kind of the spirit of the web. The spirit of the web is you declare a bunch of stuff, and then the browser makes a choice about which part of it to render to you. So that is.
Give me one more.
As an answer is one way of doing it. But obviously, if you stood down there the whole thing and then deciding which bits to display, you're still creating a lot of data transmission to do that. So they're basically doing that in between and setting something different through. And the question there is, so there is some nuance here, because there's obviously value. You don't want to outlaw sites that transform other sites. That would be a bad idea. So like this Google proxy or some of the indie web tools that we have, with feed reading off HTML pages, things like that. But there is a challenge when this is being sold as this is the internet to people who don't have much of an alternative. It's like, oh, Facebook works great, but everything else works in some slightly damaged way. Is a bit problematic.
EFF concludes, while we applaud Facebook's efforts to encourage more websites to provide support for low-end feature phones by stripping out heavy content, that would be the right way to do it, by the way, is to put the burden on the site, to offer a special version. We would like to see internet.org try harder to achieve its very worthy objective of connecting the remaining two-thirds of the world to the internet. We have confidence it would be possible to provide a limited free internet access service that is secure.
Oh, okay, so here's the principles. Okay, good.
Doesn't rely on Facebook and its partners to maintain a central list of approved sites. That's, there's two things. It's insecure, but also Facebook's a gatekeeper. Until then, internet.org will not be living
I keep crawling out of
this is
the picture.
What the hell?
Oh.
This is for the Nexus 5, 6,
Galaxy S5, Samsung Galaxy S6, and Note 4. I'm going to order it right away, and I'll demonstrate it when it comes in. Wait a minute, they're three different companies. Space Shield, Circuit Bay, and Planet. Or are those all three different styles?
Yeah. Those styles, yeah.
Which one should I, what's Circuit Bay level?
And I saw it because Google retweeted the Google Store Twitter account.
Huh. Which one, chatroom, which one should I get? Skrillex Live, Space Shield, Circuit Bay, or Planet? Let's see, Planet. You think my son will have more respect for me if I get one of these cases?
I'm not sure.
I'm leaning towards the Space Shield.
He's gonna say Skrillex is so over there.
Yeah.
Skrillex is like 2010. Come on, Dad.
Yeah. Yeah. He is kind of, isn't he?
Yeah.
Obviously, he likes now is, Alright. Dead Mouse.
Yeah,
is
Andrew.
Gone. Yeah, ask Andrew. Who's there?
But he's in Florence at the moment.
Is he? How nice for him.
Responded.
And here's an article from Wired Magazine on how it works. Google and Skrillex? I like the question. That is, I think that's editorial. Right now, wow, man, these takeovers. Okay. You know the new thing they do with takeovers is they move the close button around? So you have to, like, really look at the ad to figure out where you get rid of it.
Oh, I know, it's so awful.
They hide it. They move it around.
We got rid of pop-ups. We got rid of pop-ups, and they're back.
It keeps... do you guessing for at least, like, 3 seconds so that they can register you as a view, right?
Exactly.
That's exactly... Where is the X?
Yep.
It's a new game. Oh, Skrillex designed these himself. What a surprise. His real name is Sunny Moore. Phone cases are supposed to be fun.
One more.
I really like really crazy phone cases around right now. See, the guy is British. I don't know where he's from.
No, I love his phone. And he did like 20 designs. His favorite was, quote, like Windows 95.
Oh.
It was a super vaporware one.
Oh. He's not even speaking. Making sense. He is a DJ. Is he a DJ or what is he?
Yes, he's a
DJ and producer. He makes music.
I had this really crazy dream when I was really young. I was in my house, and in my room, this is the dream, and I wake up in the dream, and I look out my window, and this blue light flies into my backyard. And moments later, these two aliens open the door to my room.
The Dumbening of America.
I cover my face under the covers and watch them. Looking at them like so frightened and so afraid, it was so real. And then they sort of like walked around me, like stared at me. And
why do you think this is a dream?
So I'm saying. That's the realest dream I've had.
This
real,
is
real,
so
real
horrible.
Dream.
Google hopes this is a model for other artists and creators, more edition partners coming. Okay. Somebody at Google, probably Larry Page, really likes Skrillex.
There has been a rumor floating around for a few months now, and Android Police has kind of been all over it, about customizable cases. So I don't know if this ties into that. And one of the rumors actually is using Google Maps to create totally custom cases for Nexus devices and stuff.
Huh.
So, you know, who knows? Maybe this is something that we're going to hear more about at I.O., kind of a broadening of this. This is like a little teaser, and then we get to I.O. You remember what we just did with Skrillex? Now you can do it with Google Maps or whatever. How would you use what? What do you do? You put on different cases based on your mood?
Yes. Buy more cases.
Apparently.
Yeah, I don't get it. This is, I kickstarted it. I put some money in this one. I'm a backer. I pledged $109 for the next pack. Didn't we talk about this on the show? The first truly modular smartphone case.
Yeah, we did.
Yeah. See? All the little bits and pieces. I'll be trailing bits of my phone case as I walk around.
It'll prepare you for Project Dara when you get that.
Yeah. It's kind of just a warm-up.
Yep.
So what did I get? $109. special edition Magenta next pack in 4 modules. So the modules, you could have an SD card reader, an amplified speaker, a flashlight, more power, temperature and humidity sensor, USB flash. See, this is better than Skrillex. There's an air quality sensor, a breathalyzer, a laser. There's a backup drive and a dummy slot. My luck, I'll get 2 dummy slots. I guess they're funded. Look at this. They wanted $50,000. They got $20,000. They still have 9 days to go. Next pack.
Thanks to schmucks like you.
Thanks to schmucks like you. You know, I every once in a while like to go back and look at all the Kickstarter projects.
I know.
That I backed and never got anything from. Just a reminder of what a true sucker I am.
Fuck off. So did you see the $9 computer one? Chip?
Yeah. Is that a Kickstarter?
That's a Kickstarter.
It's called Clip, I think.
Chip.
Chip, that's it.
I just put the link in there.
Yeah, we tried to get them up. They were for last week for the Space Savers, but they were busy. So it's a $9 computer. They raised $1.5 million. $5 at a time. 28,848 backers. So it's like a Raspberry Pi, right?
Yeah.
First
$9 computer. It's a cheaper Raspberry Pi. Or HDMI. Tip does computer things. Save your documents to Chip's onboard storage. Surf the web over Wi-Fi. Play games with a Bluetooth controller.
If a $9 computer could do this, what do we need project at internet.org for?
Thanks, Chip.
Portable.
Hey, Chip.
It's connectivity.
Chip. And you can use Chip.
It's connectivity's the tough part, isn't it?
You might have noticed.
This is kind of weird. This is like, they're making money on the cables, aren't they?
Right.
And we're so excited to see what you can do with a $9 computer. Kickstarter, we need your help.
We're going to have them on this week.
This week they're going to be at
yeah.
The
yeah.
So Jerry, watch Saturday. They're coming up.
In fact, Chip, on Kickstarter today.
They still have 16 days to go. It's not too late. I doubt there's any $9 pledges left. No. Yep, there are. There's still something to get make your very own $9 computer. There's a chip and a composite cable. For maximum bare bones enjoyment. That's cool. Yeah, we'll find out what's going on with that. Let's take another break, I guess. Why don't you guys look through the run down and see if there's anything you're interested in.
Sure.
While I talk about something I'm interested in, LegalZoom.com. Are you the next world famous entrepreneur? Maybe it's not fame you're looking for. You just want to help people. Whatever your motivation, if you're an innovator, it is easier than ever to launch your dream. You know that. LegalZoom's here to help. Help you incorporate or form an LLC to start your business as we did. LLC. Register those trademarks to protect your products and services. We also do that. Apply for a patent to secure your invention. You can do that too. For a lot less than you think at LegalZoom. For over a decade, LegalZoom has helped more than 1 million entrepreneurs just like you turn their ideas into reality. And we've got a special for the month of May. For a limited time, you can get special savings on any trademark, copyright, or provisional patent application at LegalZoom.com. They can even help you if you have a great idea and you don't know where to turn. Now, they're not a law firm. I want to be clear about this. But you can get advice from LegalZoom's network of independent attorneys in most states. Choose the attorney based on their profile, but on their reviews as well on LegalZoom.com. So you can get the guidance you need to get your great idea off the ground. LegalZoom does it all for you. I love it. We've done incorporation stuff there. We've done trademarks. We've done our will. That too. Make the smart choice for your business, LegalZoom.com. Don't forget to use the word TWIG, T-W-I-G, in the referral box at checkout to get the special discount. LegalZoom.com, promo code T-W-I-G. Thank them so much for their support of this week. Google. Weird. We talked about this on
this week.
Security Now. Yesterday,
mobile operators in Europe are saying we're going to block online advertising. Kind of ad block for you.
Talk about net unneutral.
Well, you know, it's the examples they give are a little scary. Free games that are ad supported, and they just take the ad right out. You didn't really want that, did you? So what's the story here? This is again, this is Europe. This comes stories.
It's a report. It's sources. Who knows?
Although the Financial Times says one European wireless carrier has already installed the blocking software in its data centers and plans to turn it on before the end of the year. Comes from an Israeli startup called Shine. I mean, the details are pretty good here. Tens of millions of mobile subscribers around the world will be opting into ad block by the end of the year, said the chief marketing officer of Shine. If this scales, it could have a devastating impact on the online advertising industry. He says that with a smile.
And every site supported by Amazon.
Well, that's what worries me a little bit. It wouldn't affect us, but the video that they show, let me see if I can find this technology, shows them just stripping the ads out of stuff.
This is like the next toxic version of the internet.org problem of putting proxies there.
Right.
Yeah, it is.
And, you know, some of the carriers have done this, did this kind of thing. I think they've done ad interjection rather than ad stripping.
Yeah, they put ads in.
One of the Canadian ones did, didn't they? Is that cool?
Yep.
Yeah, there was one long ago, there was one 10 years ago, I think I mentioned the show before, that we fought it and kind of asked a lot of other publishers that won in the United States. You couldn't take over our page and do something to it with a browser add-on.
Shine says, eliminating intrusive ads is a consumer right, even if it undermines the business model of online publishers that rely on advertising. Online advertising is out of control, and it's polluting the user experience.
How ridiculous.
Well, I'm not completely unsympathetic. It can be annoying, can it? We were just talking about pop-ups, X's.
Well, the equivalent would be if your cable system cut off the ad for you.
Yes.
Well, but they had a version that would actually like find the ads and skip them, and they're like, no, you can be shut down if you do that. So then they had the 30-second skip one button that they took that up to.
Let's see if I can find this.
There's the answer possible with
the website. Well, it also brings down the science. Look at this. This is also from China. A 5-minute session. A gaming app with ads, 5 megabytes of data downloaded, 50 kilobytes without the ad. Maybe that's why the
that's why they're doing
they
the data.
How many have we made?
They'll do lower resolution versions of photos. Next.
Ad blocking is a right, says the CMO, Roy Carthy. It just shows you. I can't disagree with him, but at the same time, I worry about. Well, there's lots of free games that are.
Yeah, we. One tree.
Right. I mean, it is a problem. I mean, it ties back to the instant articles thing as well, which I know we talked about in the same class.
Yeah.
But that they're saying, you know, the actual argument is. Wow, you publishers have really made a mess of your website. Let's take
one
that
more. You maybe have two trees. So we can make three trees.
Right.
Yes.
So in the US under net neutrality.
That's not a lot.
Bits upon their pointed rounds. And it's on Google.
Three or four trees.
Sits there and gives me nothing every time it fetches things on the blacklist of advertising.
Depend on the number of branches.
Then that looks that.
But there are trees. Some of the trees only need six, and some of them that we need eight.
On the proxy side, then it's.
Right. It's a question
of
But it depends where you're putting the proxy. I potentially want to put things through.
this one.
Google GWT proxy that I linked earlier.
There may be 30 on that one.
Because it's stripping out JavaScript and large images.
Or more, I don't know, I didn't count them.
If you put, like if I put, you know, I don't think of some large ad infested site, TechCrunch. If I put TechCrunch through the Google app, Google proxy, all the ads have gone.
Yeah, but that's you doing that. That's different than a carrier doing it. And of course, the suspicion is that the carrier may at some point say, if you would like, hey, TechCrunch, if you would like your ads to go through to the viewers, we could arrange that for a small fee.
Right. This is just go around in circles like this. Part of the reason that this article is attractive is that it is stripping out a lot of this, crap that makes these websites.
No question, users don't want all that junk, right?
Right. And so that is. And we go through these cycles in technology as well. So when we went to mobile websites, the MDoc version of the website was effectively doing that. You were booting a version of the website that didn't bring the browser to its knees because the mobile phones were capable of. And so that was the reason, the way to get out from under the weight of Conway's law that makes your website turn into a mirror of your org chart and have anybody able to inject, you know, extra revenue, allegedly revenue generating stuff into it, which is the problem that the publishers had. And so instant articles is another iteration of that, where Facebook is saying, okay, we're gonna write a special browser that is really fast and responsive because it's ignoring all the crap that your business department is making you put in. But we'll give you a little loophole to put in some certain kinds of ads that fit in with our worldview here.
This exists because users hate the all the junky ads. So, but
that's
at the same time,
of very
users don't trust what's going on.
Big one.
In the long run, not in your interest for a variety of reasons. Gardner Nocheno is telling me that Shine, the Israeli company, is financed by Three, the UK mobile carrier.
Oh, jeez.
So there you have it. Now we know. But isn't that the temptation if you're an ISP? And boy, this one looks good because you can always say to your customers, see, what a great experience we're giving you.
Well, you know, it is an issue between, with these sites that have had this sort of craft creep, that is a problem.
Yeah.
So,
and advertisers brought this on themselves. And so did sites. They brought it on themselves.
Was this the sites that, is this the sites more than the advertisers? But the advertisers, you know,
Advertisers push. They keep pushing. It's up to the
sites
to say, no, I want to protect my experience, the experience of my readers.
Right.
I talked to somebody recently on a certain site that's doing membership stuff, and they said that the conversion rate, going after people who had ad blockers and saying, would you like to join, actually got a very high conversion rate.
Would you like to join?
You want to support the site.
Oh,
I'm feeling guilty about blocking the ads.
Yeah, blocking the ads.
So instead, I'll give you the money. Give us a buck, come on. It's like Amanda Palmer. Those are the people who came up to her and said,
right.
I ripped your CD. I'm sorry, here's $10.
Yeah. Yeah.
But that's the thing, is that did they give those subscribers of...
Cat butt! Get that!
Cat
butt!
A pop-up cat.
That's a cat pop-up. That was a cat takeover of Kevin's video feed.
If they target the ad block people, do they then serve a version that doesn't got ads in, or do they still have to keep running their own ad blocker to keep the ads out?
decide, should we cover this? What's it going to be? Facebook owns the Oculus Rift. It's a VR helmet. Is this going to be the announcement of an actual product? Or what? Step
well,
into the Rift is what the invite says.
So at the same time, Google moved to the head of search design to Cardboard.
Yeah.
So yeah. there's a VR, AR war.
We cannot. Yeah. Do you think, I bet you, I actually predict this on Sunday, we'll see at Google I.O., we'll see some AR. I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm sure you will.
Yeah. Not VR, but AR. So I'm curious what's going on here. Maybe you could reorder this.
Just to be sure here, is Cardboard just AR, or is it also
Cardboard's
VR?
Cardboard's VR only.
VR.
Yeah. Well, Google does have some VR, some AR technology.
We also might be see more VR. Then.
I personally am not sold on the VR thing.
No, I'm just saying we might see more. But, I mean, again,
oh yeah, Google's going to do VR too. Sure, Cardboard.
Yeah, there's investment in Cardboard. Right?
They shipped Cardboard at the last Google line.
Yep.
And of course, I wish we'd see sales numbers for the Galaxy Gear VR, but that's Samsung selling a cheap. It's only a couple $100 because it's really just a plastic holder for your smartphone. You're inside the Galaxy S5, it's a Note 4, and then there's an S6 one. Glass is not AR either, I should point out. It's looked like glass might be augmented reality. It's not, it's just a little screen over your eyebrow.
Why is that not augmented reality?
Augmented reality is it's superimposed. It's a heads-up display. It's augmenting reality. I guess, depends what you
mean. Well, it's giving you directions and saying, you know, turn left up there.
That's just putting your phone interface over your phone.
I know, but it's still AR.
All right, Kevin, is it AR?
Is which AR?
Glass.
Sorry. Not really. I mean, it is, it's AR in the same way that having a phone is AR, but it's not doing overlays.
But we've all seen, maybe we haven't, the browser that you can run on your phone where it uses the camera and it superimposes on top of the picture information about the businesses on the street. That's to me what I think of as augmented reality, whereas you're looking at glasses would be even better. You're looking at something and more information is provided you or a user interface or something like that. I feel like glasses, and that was kind of a disappointment for me. I was hoping it was augmented reality. We saw it. It wasn't just really the screen of your eyebrow.
Yeah, I mean, there are definitional arguments about it, but that's...
Right. Well,
There's... Because if the information that's coming up is location-aware and has some sense of what you're looking at, even if it isn't trying to do an actual realistic overlay, that's still potentially useful. That's like the Terminator view, where it puts up little captions on things. You can imagine that as a form of AR, but it's more practical to... I'm going to replace other people's faces with masks and things, or those kinds of ideas. But you could do like superimposed name tags on people, which is allegedly something Google built and then backed away from.
Oh, really? Oh, yeah. Interesting. But even more than that, what I'd love to know, reputation score, email address, whatever, that would be great. So Google had that. And thought, oh crap.
Creepy line. What was it, Kevin? You did the creeping crop, creepy line.
Well, creepy crop is a different problem. Yeah, that's it.
I know, I just like the alliteration, that's all.
Creepy line like that, yeah.
Letter to the president from Google, Apple, and others. Dear President Obama, went out yesterday. Washington Post obtained the letter. We, the undersigned, represent a wide variety of civil society organizations dedicated to protecting civil liberties, human rights, and innovation online, as well as technology companies, trade associations, and security and policy experts. We are writing today to respond to recent statements by some administration officials regarding the deployment of strong...
I have to run again. Whatever, I like it or not.
Companies deliberately weaken security of their products. We request the White House instead focus on developing policies that will promote rather than undermine wide adoption of strong encryption technology. Such policies will in turn help to promote and protect cybersecurity, economic growth, and human rights both here and abroad.
site, but that post is there.
we'll stop for tonight. Because there are many to do before I am finished. So I will say thank you for those who were visiting, and hope to see you again another time. Good night.